last week, you're going to love this week.
You can't cope with Bristol.
Oh, Bristol. Not again.
Oh, boy. Everybody's smoking at Bristol.
This ain't no Sunday afternoon drive.
ESPN, the world's leader in motorsports coverage, welcomes you live to Bristol International Raceway in Tennessee for the NASCAR Winston Cup Food City 500. It is a very cool and somewhat windy day in the northeast hills of Tennessee. The temperature only 52 degrees and skies are overcast at the moment. The quest for the Cup standings after five races of the 1995 season show us that Dale Earnhardt has not won a race, but he's on top because of consistency. Sterling Marlin 67 behind, and then things really tighten up with only 5 points separating third through fifth. Six through ten are separated by 42 points, with John Andretti holding down the 10th spot. Hi, everyone. I'm Bob Jenkins. Welcome to Bristol. Get set for some great action. You know, officially, the short track season opens in Richmond. It's less than a mile in length, but I think most people feel that these next three races constitute the short track season: Bristol, North Wilkesboro, and Martinsville. And what a better place to start than right here at Bristol, with 36 degrees of banking and speeds around 125 miles an hour. Both Ned and Benny have won on this racetrack, but when Ned won, the track wasn't in its current configuration.
Bob, it was the same length as it is today, but the banks were only 24 degrees. But we had a lot of action on the racetrack back then, but not nearly as much today because the speeds were not as high. There's no escape routes. When someone gets in trouble in front of you, there's not much of a place to go. Similar to the situation last week at Darlington, so I think we're going to see a lot of action here again today.
This racetrack was banked to 36 degrees in 1969. It's fashioned after Dayton, Ohio, Salem, Indiana, and Winchester, Indiana, some racetracks that the ARCA division used to run. But you're right, it's a tough racetrack. The groove is very narrow and the car's awfully fast. We are going to see more like we saw at Darlington last week. Some guys had some trouble in inspection. Bill Weber on that story.
Well, Benny, when you come here, it's not really the aerodynamics. There are some other things teams are looking for, and NASCAR's looking for them too. First of all, tire stagger. You don't hear much about it anymore because Goodyear builds it into the race tires. Here's how your passenger car travels down the highway in a straight line like this on a flat surface. But here's how the cars at Bristol try and get around this track, constantly turning left. Left side tires bigger, or smaller rather, than the right sides. Now, when able to enhance that, teams are allowed to build in camber. That's the angle at which the tire attacks the track, rather. 1.8 degrees. If you go to 2.0, say that's that, you can't get through inspection. That's what happened here. But when teams got here, the tire stagger was greater than they had anticipated. More stagger meant more camber. Terry Labonte's Kellogg Chevrolet was one of the teams that could not get through inspection. They tried three times. That's why they're one of the fastest cars, but they're pitting on the backstretch. They've got a lot of company back there. John Kernan has some of that.
Bill, along with Labonte, you got to look at Sterling Marlin now. They had the same problem. They were able to get it fixed, go through the inspection line, and qualify during the first round, but they weren't very fast. Sterling starting all the way back to 31st spot. He will join Terry Labonte, who starts 21st after second round qualifying on the backstretch. Very tough for them to win from there. This is kind of a jumbled field, but one guy who really not a surprise if he's starting back in the 25th spot is a defending national champion, Dale Earnhardt. Dale Earnhardt, though, will be pitting on the front stretch because he is the champ. Now let's go to Dr. Jerry Punch.
Well, one driver whose week went from bad to worse at Darlington is beside me. That's Bobby Labonte. After fighting a flu all week and feeling miserable just trying to practice the car, his week got considerably worse on lap 217. Take a look at what happened. One of 15 caution flags, a record at Darlington, and Bobby, a victim, trying to slow down to avoid two spinning cars in front. His Interstate Battery Chevrolet spins, and he gets tagged right in the door by Dick Trickle. Now, Labonte able to get himself out of the car to the wall, but unfortunately, after being taken to McLeod Regional Medical Center, the diagnosis was, number one, an atypical pneumonia, and number two, a cracked scapula or shoulder blade. Now, Bobby is going to start the car today. He did not qualify. David Green qualified it. Bobby, how long will you run?
I'm sure I'll run to the first caution, Jerry. You know, that's, you know, here at Bristol, it's so tough, and I mean, it's hard. It's going to be hard to get out of here just because I don't want to, but Better for the whole Interstate Batteries race team this weekend for me to give David a shot at it, because he practiced all week, qualified the car. You know, and got a good idea of what the car is going to do during the race. So, this one's here for him.
Well, as Bobby Labonte fires him up then, and they have given the command on pit road, Bob, he is one of a number of recognizable names that will miss this race today.
Well, that's right. Roy Allen has resigned from the Hooters team in the past week, and Hut Strickland was here trying to get that car up to qualifying speed. However, he did not qualify for the race. There are a total of 8 drivers that did not make it into the show, including Steve Kinzer, who didn't qualify fast enough. The engines have been started. We'll be back with the starting lineup and the Boot City 500 in a moment. For cars that can benefit from higher octane, Texaco Clean System 3 Power Plus and Power Premium are formulated to clean your engine's intake valves, fuel injectors, and combustion chambers while you're driving, to give you smooth starts and sure acceleration. Just give us 5 tanks, and we think Power Plus and Power Premium will make quite an impression on you.
Add more life to your car! Take it to the store!
Okay, no one really wants to talk about tires, but you know what?
Firestone's having this big sale, and I'm talking about it. Don't touch that remote. I'm looking at tires. The big, the bad, the walk on water. I'm looking at sale prices, too. But you don't want to talk about it. So don't. Just take your Hopper to catch the red light so people can check me out, car, and go. You know why? It's big. It's Firestone. It's the big tire sale at Firestone. And like it or not, people are going to be talking.
Save big on high-mileage FR440 radials now at Firestone retailers and Sunday's ad.
This spring, NAPA is celebrating its 70th anniversary with low prices on some great parts and accessories. Pick up NAPA motor oil for only 89 cents a quart. A NAPA lawn and garden battery, just $17.99. Or buy NAPA SensiTrac shocks or struts and get 60 minutes of free long-distance calling. So stop into NAPA soon, your complete auto parts source since 1925.
We keep America running.
We keep America running.
Car in NASCAR Winston Cup history was back. Introducing the race-modified Chevrolet Monte Carlo.
ESPN Speed World coverage is being brought to you by Haviland Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car. By Firestone retailers, come in now for the April price performance sale. And by NAPA Auto Parts, we keep America running. Well, the cars begin to move off of the grid here on the front stretch. Let's take a look at this track in detail. There it is, 0.533 miles in length, 650 feet on the front stretch and back stretch. 36 degrees of banking in the corners, and the straightaways are banked at 16 degrees. Now the race analysis. We'll go 500 laps. The race record is 101 miles an hour. They'll pit for fuel at about 160, and the purse amounts to over $1 million. Here is the starting lineup for today's race. Mark Martin is on the pole in the Valvoline Ford. Car number 6 with 124.605 mile per hour run. Jeff Gordon from Pittsboro, Indiana, in the DuPont Chevrolet starts outside the front row. He qualified at 124.4. In the second row, it is Kyle Petty in the Coors Light Pontiac, car number 42. Outside of him in the second row will be Derek Cope from Spanaway, Washington, the Straight Arrow Products Ford, car number 12. In the third row, it's Bobby Labonte starting the race, soon to be replaced by David Green. Ted Musgrave on the outside of that row. In the fourth row, it is Ricky Craven and John Andretti. As you look at the rest of the starting field, I guess we can anticipate another action-packed afternoon of racing. Huh, Benny?
I would almost guarantee it. And you know, David Green qualified at Interstate Batteries Chevrolet in fifth spot. And guess what? Bobby Labonte, the fact that he is injured, he has chosen to go to the back of the field. He's going to start last after a great qualifying run.
And from row 10 on back, all of those drivers are pitting on the backstretch today. There we see Bobby Labonte, who has already gone to the inside and worked his way back to the back of the pack. We're about ready to go racing.
I think we're going to go one more lap before we get the green flag.
Okay.
There's last week's winner, Sterling Marlin, way back in row number 16. And here are the provisional starters, Michael Waltrip, Steve Grissom, and Ward Burton and Dave Marcus. So the field has been given the signal now. One lap until the green. We talked about the eight drivers that did not qualify for the race. There they are. They include Joe Nemechek and Butch Miller, Steve Kinzer, Strickland, Standridge, Mike Wallace, Jeremy Mayfield, and Brad Teague. Well, we got a lot of in cars for you again. Rusty Wallace for one. Mark Martin has a roof cam. Dick Trickle will also have a roof cam on the top of his Quality Care Ford. Ted Musgrave will provide us with one also. And we'll be listening to him on the radio. There is Morgan Shepherd, and also one in Kenny Schrader's car. Here comes the field off the fourth corner, and the Boot City 500 is under green.
In the last couple of years.
He really did. That outside, especially in the early going, is tough to get traction on. Bill Elliott's called up there way back in the pack and wants to get back in single line.
We hardly saw two groups here at all yesterday afternoon, but perhaps with more rubber being put down on the racetrack since then, we'll see two groups here this afternoon. It is Mark Martin leading. Kyle Petty running a close second, and here's the action from Morgan Shepherd's car. Look at this. Kyle Petty noses his way to the inside of Mark Martin and takes the lead, and Cope goes to second.
And Mark Martin will go to fourth. He got caught up on that outside once Kyle got on the inside of him.
So Kyle Petty has the lead of this race.
Kyle Petty led the race in Daytona. Cindy hasn't led, I don't think, so gotta feel good at the front of the pack.
Okay, and he's pulling away from Cope, Jeff Gordon, Mark Martin, Ricky Craven, Rusty Wallace, Jeff Bodine, John Andretti, Ted Musgrave, Jeff Burton, and Ricky Rudd.
And there Jeff Gordon goes into second place behind Derek Cope. Mark Martin trying to get alongside Cope, and he is, and will take that spot away.
Now let's see if Cope can get back down in. Yes, he got back.
They had enough of a gap there in front of Ricky Craven that he could get back in line. Kyle Petty pulled away a little bit.
Yeah, sure is. Again, we talk about the spotters and their importance, but they're real important here because they can tell a driver when he can get back down into that inside line without getting another car.
Kyle Petty'd run off a good year if he liked the place, wouldn't he?
Yeah, he did tell us last week he didn't like it, didn't he?
In no uncertain terms. Jeff Gordon, of course, dominated the race at Darlington last week, led the most laps before being taken out in an accident. We're inside Mark Martin's car. We were there for a moment as he runs back in third position. Then comes Cope, and then the battle between Ricky Craven and Rusty Wallace, who won his very first NASCAR Winston Cup event on this track.
That's fifth spot. Rusty's trying to take it away. He's alongside. We'll take this spot away from Craven. Now Craven's going to get on the outside. There'll be problems for him.
Yeah, he's going to lose some positions here because he just can't get back to the inside. There goes Jeff Bodine, John Andretti, Ted Musgrave.
And Andretti trying to get alongside Jeff Bodine. Jeff Bodine blew an engine in practice yesterday afternoon, hit the wall, only got a couple of laps of practice. Had to spend, they were here at 6:30 last night still working on that car.
Yeah, when he blew the engine yesterday in the final practice session, cut an oil line, and it went into the pit area, but it didn't strike anybody. Here's John Kernan.
Yes, Bob, that was very fortunate. Nobody got hurt. He also, Ricky Rudd, got into that oil. But Jeff Bodine, his crew worked till 7 o'clock last night, and they just finished that car up this morning. They had to replace the rear end housing, the left trailing arm, and all of the right front suspension, as well as the motor.
Here's the battle for sixth position, John Andretti trying to get to the inside of Jeff Bodine. In the meantime, Bodine catches up to Wallace and Cope.
Yeah, rusty.
Bodine is way up out of the group.
I think it must have got just a little bit of a tap from the 37 car of John Andretti. And Jeff Bodine is Darrell Waltrip. Oh, and Jeff finally does spin. Does a 360, and so far no one is involved except Bobby Hamilton.
He spun to the bottom of the track, but he too is going, and so no caution. Both drivers doing 360s and going right on.
Wow. You see Terry Labonte in the 5 car.
Bodine trying to get some positions back that he lost in this incident.
You see Jeff Bodine, he's caught to the outside. Now, Darrell Waltrip has plans of going, and Jeff Bodine comes down. It looks like he and Darrell might have touched, Ed. What do you think?
It was very slight, if so at all. But anyway, Jeff spins around, does a 360. You think keeps going.
Let's see if we can see here. I think there was probably just a little bit of a tap from Darrell. He thought he would follow him. You saw his left front smoking as he tried to stop to avoid hitting Jeff Bodine.
Yeah, he was on the brakes trying very hard not to make contact, but he made slight contact. And there down to the right on the inside of the racetrack, you see Bobby Hamilton spinning around, but he also kept going. On a cool Sunday afternoon here in Bristol, Tennessee, there are the top five after 18 of 500 laps in the Food City 500.
Most trackers can follow the trail only as long as the weather holds up. Unless it's a tracker spurred on with genuine AC spark plugs. AC plugs fire faster than lightning for performance so smooth, even the thunder claps. And that'll keep your engine on the trail to a longer life.
Call 1-800-AC-DELCO. It's like buying time.
So better track down some AC spark plugs.
For the best name brand auto parts you can buy. For quality parts that meet the toughest inspection standards in the business. For lifetime parts warranties, good for as long as you own your vehicle. And for guaranteed low prices, check daily to beat the competition. Don't fool around at just any parts store. Get serious. Get Western Auto. Western Auto.
Rusty Wallace stock car. Awesome. One opened up.
Tennis. The sport of gentlemen. Where things are always returned to their proper place. Faults are taken in stride. Everyone serves with pride. And love means never having to say you're sorry.
Davis Cup continues tonight at midnight. Advantage ESPN.
Welcome back to live coverage of the Food City 500 from Bristol. The leader is Kyle Petty on the left of your screen now in the middle. And the blue and red number 42, Jeff Gordon, is chasing him. We talked about how Kyle has led a couple of races this year in Daytona and Atlanta, but he has not led this many laps since 1993.
Wow.
Here's Dr. Jerry Punch with more.
Yeah, Kyle Petty's crew chief, Barry Dodson, is sort of rolling the dice when it comes to the engine here today. While most teams have gone a little conservative on their gear, running about a 5.14 after qualifying, Kyle has gone the other direction, according to Barry Dodson. They have put a 5.43 gear in that Pontiac, and they are turning right at 9,000 RPM a lap. Last time by, we're told, Kyle said it's about 8,900 RPM, and guys, that's going to be awfully tough on the bounce brake.
As a matter of fact, I saw Keith Simmons and his crew this morning putting new valve springs on that 42 car in anticipation of what Jerry Punch is talking about. They knew they were going to turn it a lot. They needed the best valve spring they could get.
Now the question becomes, can it last for 500 laps around this place?
That's the next question. Will that baby hang together? There we see Bobby Labonte. He wanted a caution flag early on to let David Green get in the car, but it looks like he's going to be a lap down when that happens.
A lot of these cars that they're coming up on, they actually caught the tail end of the lead lap a little bit earlier than they normally would, but when we had that situation with Jeff Bodine spinning, everybody had to back off back there. The leaders were out there running in free traffic, free off traffic, and so they were able to really pick up a lot of speed on the other cars.
Watching from Mark Martin's roof cam now, he's running in third spot. Up ahead are Jeff Gordon and Kyle Petty. Now Jeff looks to the inside of Kyle into turn one. Cannot make the move.
As a matter of fact, that group has pulled away from Kyle Petty. Bobby Labonte and that group of cars have put a couple of car lengths on Kyle. It's like his car is getting loose, pushing, something is happening to it. And Jeff trying to look once again inside.
See how close to the bottom of the racetrack they run, especially going into the turn and coming off the turn. And then they go up next to the wall as they come out of the turn.
Looks like he's got a run. Jeff, whoa, didn't quite make it.
Jerry, what's the update on the Bobby Labonte, David Green situation?
Well, Bob, they would like to have had a caution about lap 10 to be able to get Bobby out of the car. You know, it's not as much the shoulder, although it's very physically demanding here. The pain is pretty uncomfortable, but it's the pneumonia that creates the problem. Bobby would run maybe 5 or 6 laps in practice and come in and be literally out of breath in the race car. That's their primary concern, the fact that he can get exhausted very quickly. Not the shoulder, but the lung situation. So they're hoping for a caution at any time. But as Bobby told me, we need a caution early, and I just hope it isn't me.
Yeah, he certainly doesn't need to hit anything right now with the pain he's in because of the shoulder. There we see Earnhardt.
Dale has moved up to 11th position already.
There's our first three cars. Kyle Petty, Jeff Gordon, Mark Martin. And you see that black car just coming into the picture. Rusty Wallace now running fourth.
And John Andretti is in fifth position.
There's Rusty and Andretti.
Dale Earnhardt is 6 7/10 seconds behind the leader. I'll tell you, coming from, what, 24th position?
And here's a battle for the lead coming off turn four.
Jeff Gordon will get the lead. Let's see if Mark Martin can go to second as they keep Petty high on the track. But Kyle fights back and prevents Martin from getting second spot. But we do have a new leader, Jeff Gordon. Now Mark Martin moves alongside Kyle, and they race side by side down the straightaway. I believe Martin is going to get second position here in turn number two.
Once you get on that inside, they're touching the end off.
Now look at Rusty Wallace.
Yeah, he has caught them. John Andretti coming right along with him.
Sean Parker, one of the 50 crewmen, last night told me in the hotel that Rusty's car is running awfully well. They felt like they could win today.
Rusty is the master of the short track. He has won 9 of the last 20 short track races, and Dale Earnhardt picks up another position that puts him now in 9th. He started 25th. There is Jeff Gordon, whose best finish here at Bristol, 17th. It occurred in his first start here in April of 1993. By the way, Jeff has led at least one lap in every single event so far this year.
Here are the 3rd, 4th, and 5th place cars, Kyle Petty, Rusty Wallace, and John Andretti.
And you can see that Jeff Gordon is a few car lengths ahead of that group. Bobby Labonte still is on the lead lap. Now he may be going a lap down. Yes, as Gordon and Martin come to the inside.
Morgan Shepherd and Bobby Hamilton, the Citgo Ford and the STP Pontiac, both those cars have been running together since the very beginning of the race. Hamilton spun.
And you can see that the leader is not too far behind them there. Just what a car separating them. Rick Mass is right on the back bumper of Bobby Hamilton.
They are 29th and 30th. Rick Mass is 31st, and he will be the next car to go a lap down. Right behind Rick Mass. Larson just ahead of Jeff.
It's not raining. I saw a drop of water on the lens of the camera. It is not raining.
The way it feels outside, then, if there's going to be any precipitation, it'll be in the form of snow. It's cool here this afternoon.
There's a couple of folks in the booth with us that drove over from Boone this morning and said they saw some snow on the way over.
Yeah, I heard on the radio that there were some snowflakes in the area.
That's occasionally sunny, though, and when the sun is out, it's much more pleasant.
Doesn't take long to get down that front straightaway, does it?
Are they on the straightaway about 2 seconds or something like that?
2.5 seconds, something like that. But in that 2.5 seconds, only about a second of that you can really relax. The rest of the time you're steering off the corner or steering into the corner. And Hamilton just needs to get by, wants to get by desperately.
They continue to run in single file at the moment with Jeff Gordon leading, Mark Martin, Kyle Petty, Rusty Wallace, and John Andretti. We'll be right back.
Conley Motor Home Center of Bradenton is having a free closeout sale on all 94 Itasca motorhomes. The Sundancer, six models to choose from, all at Conley's affordable prices. The Sunwise, all the essentials of travel in one motorhome. The Sun Cruiser, this high storage Class A motorhome is priced to sell. The Vectra, one of the best built highline motorhomes ever. And introducing the Rialta, powered by a front wheel drive Volkswagen engine. See the complete line of Itasca motorhomes at unbelievable prices only at Conley Motor Home Center, 800 Cortez Road West in Bradenton.
Action is the main attraction, showing the fun.
It's the Parts Plus
Super Chevy Show
at DeSoto Memorial Dragway, April 8th at 9th.
8th, wondering.
200 mile per hour Pro Mods.
Awesome.
Get powered buddy cars. It's the biggest all Chevy event in the country.
Plus, the BF Goodrich Tires Car Show, customs, rods, a swappy.
April 8th and 9th, DeSoto Memorial Dragway.
The Parts Plus Super Chevy Show.
Get discount coupons now at all Parts Plus stores.
Extreme Games 101. Class begins tonight at 9. On ESPN2.
Back at the Food City 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race from Bristol International Raceway in Tennessee.
See, Jeff Gordon's been able to pass Rick Mast, put in the one car, the Skoal car a lap down.
And then he went up on the outside and did it, too. That was pretty impressive that he could move up on the outside. Of course, Rick gave him plenty of running room up there, but still, that outside groove is still not the best.
Michael walked to 30 car, going to lap down to our leader. And 43 car, Bobby Hamilton, trying all he can to stay in the lead lap. See, Bobby Labonte has been able to keep up with these guys since they passed him, put him to lap down, the Interstate Battery car.
For somebody with a broken shoulder blade, he is performing very well on a physically demanding racetrack.
Michael Walker just almost lost his car there going into turn two, went high, and Bobby Labonte was able to dip under him. And here comes John Andretti.
From Ted Musgrave's family channel board, he goes to the inside of Michael Waltrip, and here comes Dale Earnhardt, who is up to seven.
That is unbelievable.
Yesterday, he was very, very fast. I told some people this morning, they asked me who were the good cars here. I said, well, the 6 car, of course, Mark Martin, the 24 car, and Dale Earnhardt, even though he started back in 24th place, he was awfully fast in practice there yesterday.
Just went to 6th. By the way, this is the place that Dale Earnhardt won his first NASCAR Winston Cup event back in 1979 in only his 16th start. Here's a Napa Field summary. The entire 36-car field and how they are running at the moment.
And every car is still running. Don't think we've had a car go in the pits yet.
I don't believe so.
Look at Sterling Marlin up to 15th already.
Yep. No caution so far. The laps clicking off very, very quickly. Boy, if we could run this thing without a caution, which, by the way, has never been done, this thing could be over in a couple of hours. But
what would we do then?
Yeah,
3 moments.
Just wait. Yeah, right. That ain't going to happen. One car is 2 laps down. Ward Burton, 36th, is 2 laps down. Everybody else on the lead lap or just 1 lap down.
Ooh, Kyle.
A little sideways coming off the corner.
Car is loose. Rusty Wallace got alongside Kyle just a moment ago, almost lost it as he tried to pass Kyle. And look at John Andretti. And Earnhardt is right on the back of this group of cars.
Third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and back in seventh is Musgrave. Tight battle here for position early.
Well, you remember I said that Earnhardt was 6 7/10 seconds behind Jeff Gordon, or the leader it was. Now he is 2 seconds behind the leader. I think Kyle Petty was leading at that time.
Closing in. Here's Dale Earnhardt's progress to sixth position after his 25th place start. Doesn't take him long. Now looking to the inside of John Andretti, unable to make the pass in turn one, but now he does. By the way, our congratulations to John and Nancy Andretti, because on Wednesday afternoon they became the parents of a new baby girl.
Olivia Elizabeth, and it says on the back of his car, it's a girl. Right on the back.
7 pounds, 11 ounces, and 19 and a half inches long. Good, healthy baby. I wish Nancy and John the best. Here comes Sterling Marlin, who has moved up to 15th position at the moment. Make that 14th. He started 31st. Last week's winner at Darlington.
With this same car, as a matter of fact.
Bill Weber has more on Sterling Marlin.
Bob, that's the same car, as Benny mentioned, that they won with last week at Darlington, but then NASCAR took it to two wind tunnels. Tony Glover told me they got it back Thursday morning, did a complete overhaul of the car, which normally takes 3 to 4 days. They did it one day and got it here. They said they weren't good at qualifying, weren't happy with the tires, but they had practiced well, and they expect to do well.
They are doing well, but Rusty Wallace just lost, what, one position, Benny?
Two positions.
Two.
Both Earnhardt and John Andretti was able to get by Rusty. It looks like Rusty is fighting a loose condition.
We're watching from the roof cam on the Family Channel 4, driven by Ted Musgrave. Here is Earnhardt. Oh, he gives Kyle Petty a little bit of a love tap.
Well, Kyle got a little bit sideways coming off the turn. Earnhardt had a run, so he just ran right up on him and bumped him. Jeff Bodine, almost losing again off of turn two as Earnhardt gets on the inside of Kyle Petty now to make the pass.
And the Bristol race fans are on their feet cheering for Dale Earnhardt, who picks up another position, and John Andretti.
Man, I thought Kyle was coming down right in the nose of that 37. We're going to have a wreck right there.
They survived.
They survived. Thank goodness.
Yeah.
Good driving, guys. I was talking to him. That's what I was told. From inside Rusty Wallace's car, you see he's turning as he comes off the corner. That time he did not have to catch the back end.
Now Andretti once again tries to position himself inside of Kyle for the fourth position.
And battle for the lead.
Mark Martin is to the inside of Jeff Gordon in the backstretch, and they touch. Jeff holds on to the lead.
Yeah, Mark backed off. Didn't drive. He could have driven on him to turn real hard and maybe wrecked both of them. He chose not to do that. Mark.
What happened is Jeff Gordon tried to... Oh, here we go. What position is this?
Fourth.
The fourth spot.
Yep, John's got it. And up front, Mark is going to try it again, and this time he makes it. Mark Martin becomes our third leader of the afternoon.
And I think that Jeff Gordon, I think, really got tired of trying to pass that traffic.
Oh!
Boy, Rusty and Kyle almost wrecked over there.
I'm telling you, Ned, they sure did. It's glorified bumper cars at the moment, but everybody is hanging on and not spinning.
Man.
Here it is again, off of the second corner.
Well, we're going to see Rusty get his left wheel down on the pavement. He and Kyle touch a little bit. Kyle goes high. Rusty gets by on the inside.
John Curtin has more on Rusty Wallace.
Bob, I just talked to his crew chief, Robin Pemberton. He said that Rusty's complained the car is fairly loose. He's having a hard time driving it. They're about 70, 65 laps away, if we stay green, from pitting. At that point in time, they'll make some adjustments to try and tighten the car up.
85 laps laps have been completed. About 160 to 65 is the pit window. Here is a battle between Bill Elliott and Dick Trickle. And let's see, where are they running?
They are running 24th and 25th.
Oh, and Elliott spins.
No, he didn't.
Well, I thought he went. How can he save it?
He lost a lap, but he didn't spin. He got sideways, and Mark went under him, and now Jeff Gordon does, and others, but Elliott saved it.
Man, oh, man, how can he save the thing? It's 90 degrees. Compared to Bonnie and Darlton last week. Now, watch this, folks. You tell me how Bill Elliott's able to keep this car going straight. Here he goes down in turn one. Down the straightaway, I'm sorry, into turn one. Goes in the corner, and the car just goes sideways.
Might have got a little bit of a nudge there from Toyota.
Oh, yeah.
I think that nudge going in at the turn.
Bill Elliott, a winner of this race back in 1988, one win at Bristol. The lead is held by Mark Martin, who also has a win at Bristol. That came in the Budweiser 500 in 1993. Back in just a moment.
Sunday, we believe in putting on our best. Maybe that's why no car company has won more races in the history of NASCAR than Chevrolet.
You know, at AutoZone, we know our customers work just as hard as we do. So we're open when they need us, at night and on Sundays. And since 2 million folks each week count on AutoZone for what they need, when they need it, we're not about to let them down. That's why we carry so many parts and why we price them so low every day. You see, selling top quality parts at low prices every day is how we make a living. But helping customers, well, that's how we make friends.
From Texaco Clean System 3 gasolines to Havoline Formula 3 motor oil and Texaco antifreeze coolant, there's no better place to take your car than to the star.
Got to treat it real good. Ooh, you got to treat it so fine. Put the pedal to the metal, mile after mile. Keep it humming all of the time. Add more life to your car.
Take it to the star.
Racing of a different kind tonight, a little slower and a lot less noisy. A special presentation of America's Cup 95 as Team Dennis Conner takes on America Cube's Mighty Mary. Now, if Dennis loses, it'll be the first time we'll be out of the America's Cup this early. Join us at 8:30 tonight for same-day coverage here on ESPN. That's 8:30 Eastern Time with the eastern part of the United States now on daylight saving time. And this is Ken Schrader, Brett Bodine, and Chuck Bounds.
And that is a race for 15th, 16th, 17th. And Bound moves into 17th. Derek Cope also goes by Brett Bodine.
Derek Cope was up among the top five in the early going. He slid back to 18th. There's Schrader in 16th and Bound going to the inside, trying to pick up a position in turn one. They go through side by side.
He'll get it. Derek Cope will come right along with him, and Brett Bodine as well.
And Martin is having trouble getting around the 40 car, and here Jeff Gordon is trying to take the lead. They're side by side with a slower car of Sachs right in front of them.
But the slower car is going to mean that
Earnhardt's going to take second. Oh, how is he?
Whoa. Oh, and Gordon's way out of shape, and he saves it. Down on the apron, he moves up right beside Earnhardt and is not intimidated whatsoever.
Once again, the 40 car of Sachs is in the preferred line, so Gordon backs off, lets Earnhardt go by, and Dale Earnhardt is now in second place.
Yeah, with all this, Mark Martin has a lead. In fact, quite a nice lead. Dale Earnhardt is in second position. Here's how all this occurred.
Well, of course, they came up on the 40 car of Sachs, and Jeff Gordon was down on the inside. Earnhardt decided he'd follow Martin up there.
And we got Kyle Petty in the wall, Ned.
No caution. Still no caution.
He bumped the wall in turn number two, but kept going. Sorry to interrupt you there.
Yeah, he's still going fine. His car seems to be awfully loose. He's definitely having handling problems. He had dropped back to about 11th position.
He was had some contact with a 41 car, I believe. Let's look at it. Ricky Craven.
Yep. Down on the inside. A little bit of a nudge. And again, Kyle, a heck of a job of saving. It touches the wall a little bit. See, Ricky Rudd went by.
And ladies and gentlemen, we have completed 106 laps, caution free. That's a surprise.
It really is.
Here's the leader, Mark Martin, trying to put a lap on Ken Schrader, with second place Dale Earnhardt just behind.
Schrader is in 21st position. Now there are 20 cars on the lead lap.
And we saw Kenny Schrader's car, the rear end of his car, as Earnhardt goes by. The back of Schrader's car wiggled just a tick as he went in the corner. That means that most of these guys are fighting a very, very loose race car.
This is Ted Musgrave's suspension cam. Remember, the track is cement, concrete.
And the black thing in the middle, that yellow thing, is the spring, the coil spring that holds the car up. The black thing in the middle of the spring is a rubber that they can take out to let that spring, to weaken that spring and change the chassis. That hose you see, the red hose, is a brake duct. It carries air into the brakes and cools them off.
He passes the Dick Trickle car, and here's our camera underneath the Trickle machine.
And you can see just how the right front wheel goes up and down, and how much camber the wheel has in it. We can see how the wheel is leaned in at the top. Now we're in the corner, so the tire is flat on the racetrack. As it goes down the straightaway, we see air under the outside of the right rear tire. That's the camber.
We finally have a car making a pit stop. Michael Waltrip is in on the back stretch.
When Dick Trickle made some contact earlier, we'll watch from this camera as he goes sideways.
Whoa!
Oh, look how he turns that thing to the right. Ooh! Man!
That's a good shot.
That's a good shot.
Michael Waltrip now coming out of the pits after making a stop on the back stretch, the Pennzoil machine.
That's the first car that's been in the pits, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
And I guess he was so loose that he just couldn't drive it.
Yeah, he had already gone a lap down out on the racetrack, and so he fought it as long as he could, run about 112 laps before he came into the pits. It'll be interesting to see how far we see others go. As far as gas is concerned, they should be able to go about 160 or so laps.
There's the leader, Mark Martin, coming up on Jeff Burton, putting a lap on him. Jeff in 18th position. There's 17 cars now on the lead lap. The next one that may go a lap down is Bobby Hamilton. And we have Earnhardt. He is in the wall hard in turn four. He has really messed up the front end of the GM Goodrich Chevrolet, but able to drive it.
Heavy, heavy damage to the left front and the oil cooler back there. If you saw the Busch race yesterday, you say, well, the oil cooler's in the radiator. That radiator is not legal in Winston Cup. The oil cooler's back there or underneath the radiator. Man, heavy damage to that car.
And this is exactly what Dale Earnhardt does not need this year if he's going to stay consistent and win that eighth championship. But the caution is out for the first time today, and it comes at the end of 117 laps. Pace car is out to slow the field, and a lot of cars will be very glad that this caution came out because they needed some adjustments.
Yes, they welcome this opportunity, no doubt about it, to come in and get some new tires on and make some adjustments to the cars. There's still 18 cars on the lead lap.
We see the 28 car, I'm sorry, of Dale Jarriott. He's worked his way up to sixth spot.
Mm-hmm. From 19th.
Yes. Very nice run. Here they come. Mark Martin, Jeff Gordon leading him down the pits here on the front stretch. Here comes John Andretti down off the banking. Rusty Wallace and Dale Earnhardt.
change for John Andretti. No adjustments. Car just a little bit tight in the middle of the turns. Work is done on the right side. The gasoline going in. They'll come around to the left side now as Tim Brewer supervising. Mark Martin is on the top. Also Jeff Gordon and John Andretti. Rusty Wallace has made a change and gone. Now John Andretti is down and away.
18.2 seconds for Jeff Gordon. A much quicker stop than Mark nor Andretti.
And cars coming out of the pits, three abreast as Earnhardt's car is in there. And the crew is looking. Here comes the pace car. I believe that Earnhardt is going to go a lap down. They're taking the car behind the wall. Earnhardt's car going behind the wall.
And we'll show you in replay what happened as the three car goes behind the wall for repairs. Here it is.
Well, it was already in a spin, Bob, as he came off of turn four. I wondered if he was up on the outside of a car lapping maybe and got up in the loose stuff and lost it.
Let's watch from the Citgo in car, Morgan Shepherd's in car, and see if we can see what happened. There he is. That's the 12 car, Derek Cope. Just a little bit of contact between the 12 and the 3 car.
Earnhardt runs down there and cuts in a little bit too quick going into the turn and clips the car of Derek Cope. And round he goes.
There is the smoking number 3 machine as it's behind the wall for repairs in the early going of the Food City 500.
Thank you, Mikey. In these days of overpriced sporting events and overpaid athletes, have you ever wondered where today's heroes are? The ones who thrive on the love of competition and not the love of money? A facility where family values still mean something, and they take pride in what they offer. The excitement, the price, the fun. Come see America's premier sport in action. Come see the Knights in black and white satin.
If you're on the lookout for quality used auto parts, and tons of them, Jim's Auto Salvage in Sebring is the first and last stop you need to make. We've been in the auto salvage business for over 25 years and have over 40 acres of parts inventory. Individuals and dealers alike will find our warehouses stocked full of late model auto and truck parts. Jim's Auto Salvage delivers daily to businesses throughout Central Florida. Save your money. Why buy new when used will do just fine? Come see us soon at Jim's Auto Salvage and Jim's Import Auto Salvage, both serving you in Sebring.
A rush of IndyCar racing. Enter the ESPN Legend Returns Sweepstakes, sponsored by Firestone, and you can go to the Indy 500 as a member of the Patrick Racing Team. Runners-up get Firestone Firehawk tires or racing jackets. To enter, visit any Firestone tire retailer or send a postcard to the ESPN Legend Returns Sweepstakes, P.O. Box 518, Hermosa Beach, California, 90254. The ESPN Legend Returns Sweepstakes, sponsored by Firestone.
Under caution for the first time in the Food City 500. We're at 122 laps now. The caution came out on lap 117 because of a wreck in turn four that has damaged heavily the number 3 car of Dale Earnhardt. Well, he's a 7-time champion going for number 8. Things like these that create setbacks. Jerry Punch is with Bobby Labonte.
Well, Bobby just climbed out of the car after about 120 laps, and Bobby, a lot longer than you had hoped to run. How do you feel?
Well, you know, Bill Earnhardt just never think he'd run 120 laps there to begin with under green, but the Interstate Batteries car is good. You know, we got boxed in there a couple times, had to really slow down, and, you know, just 3 or 4 or 5 of the lead cars got us, and, you know, a few cars are already lapped down, so I think David will do a good job for us, and, you know, I've already got him a fifth of the way there, so he can go the rest of the way.
You didn't even lose another lap changing drivers. You'd lost the lap on the racetrack. But what was worse out there, the shoulder or just trying to breathe with the pneumonia?
Basically, just trying to breathe was the biggest thing. But, you know, I kind of really didn't want to get out of it, but I knew one-fifth was how tough it was on my shoulder and stuff, so I figured the whole way would be long, would be pretty tough. So we'll try to get really good for Wilkesboro next weekend and try the whole distance.
That's Bobby Labonte, who's climbed out of the car. Now he will stay in the pits and be supportive of David Green and the team. Now, while Labonte stays here, not far behind us, the Earnhardt team continues to work, guys, and we are told they're going to replace the tie rod ends, the radiator, and much of the front suspension. So they're going to be back here for an awfully long time.
Yes, that smoke that you saw coming from Earnhardt's car was the water. It evidently broke the radiator in the crash and overheated, so they'll have to put a new radiator in it.
David Green now in for Bobby Labonte will take the green flag here in 30th position, a lap down.
Richard Childress in the black coat just walking out of the picture, radioing his orders.
Well, now there are 16 cars on the lead lap as we get ready to restart. I said 20 there just as the caution came out, but apparently a couple of the cars that had been lapped were had not shown up yet on the scoring as they came around to get the caution flag. Jeff Gordon, the leader.
Jeff Gordon is the leader. Mark Martin, second. The crowd rises as the green flag comes back out, and the Food City 500 is back under competitive condition. John Andretti is third, and Rusty Wallace and Terry Labonte.
Terry pitting on the backstretch had a good pit stop back there.
Jeff Gordon got quite a start as he has put some space between himself and Mark Martin.
Now, a race for, third spot between, was a race between Andretti and Rusty Wallace.
I thought Rusty was going to get the position because John drifted high in the corner. Rusty got the nose under, but John held him off. The Kmart Little Caesars Sub-Pizza machine driven by John Andretti. And now we're in the Miller Genuine Draft 4 driven by Rusty Wallace.
Well, the lap cards, of course, were able to go up on the inside. And that made it some drivers back in the pack a little bit tough for them here on the restart.
There's Terry Labonte. Also a nice move to the front. He's currently in fifth position.
And started way back there.
Started 21st. He was the fastest second day qualifier yesterday and had trouble during his initial session on Friday because of the inspection thing.
So our sixth place car, Ricky Rudd, the tied fourth. And 28th car, Dale Jarrett, is the next car in line, followed by Darrell Walter. DW.
Sterling Marlin is doing a nice job.
Yeah, he had a good pit stop as well back there on the back stretch and gained several positions. He had worked himself up to about 10th or 11th before the caution came out and then picked up a few spots during the pit stop.
I wonder if the fact that Earnhardt is in the pit area, garage area, working on his car is going to have any kind of
psychological
advantage for how the four cars going to run their race today. Are they going to change their strategy on how they run the race today, the four car? Oh, and a crash down one Todd 09, and the 23 car is spinning, the 43 car, and the caution flag is out.
Second time this afternoon, the caution is out. Both cars, however, able to drive away, but considerable damage to Bodine's car.
And the 32 car also of Chuck Bound.
Yeah, he has a lot of damage on his car, too.
We saw a lot of fluid coming from the 25 car. He drives directly to the garage area.
There's Chuck Bound, whose car is smoking, and here is a replay. Yeah, it's difficult to see what happened.
Yeah, really, they were so bunched up from the restart with lap cars entwined with those that were on the lead lap and everybody jockeying for position, and that position they were jockeying for was the inside of the racetrack.
That's right. Bobby Hamilton, you saw, also spun during that incident, and Bound, like Bodine, has taken his car behind the wall. And there's a parts wagon. Well, they've got some work to do on Todd's car, on Chuck's car, and of course Earnhardt's car is still behind the wall for repairs after an earlier crash. It's Jeff Gordon leading the event. Back after these messages.
There's one thing that a racing engine and a street engine have in common. You want them both to last.
Havoline Formula 3 from Texaco.
To build a race engine that holds up, you have to use the best of everything. And Havoline does that job.
No other leading motor oil offers more complete protection to help your car run better, last longer. Good enough for Robert Yates. Havoline Formula 3. Why add just any motor oil? Add more life to your car.
You can get top brands and top performance at just any auto parts store.
Get serious. Get Western Auto.
Western Auto, the stranger to the past.
Get ready for all the racing action you can handle. Phone now and get the official directory for the NASCAR Winston Cup Series. Get track maps, seating charts, driver bios and stats, scorecards and schedules for all the races, plus the latest weather, tickets, qualifying times, and a detailed trip planning guide, all for only $21.95.
Get this guide. Heck, hot bite for the pitcher on the cover.
Phone 1-800-RACE-345 now and we'll ship immediately.
Hi, my name is Mick Vigoda, right wing with the Islanders. Please, don't confuse me with the actor Abe Vigoda on the TV series Barney Miller.
Hey, pass me the puck, Fish.
Don't call me Fish, rookie!
We remain under caution at Bristol International Raceway in Tennessee, our second of the day because of a three-car crash up in turn number one. Well, there are the transporters that get these cars from race to race. They're positioned in the infield here at Bristol. And that reminds us we've got a little bit of a catching up to do as far as the Mayflower Trucker Challenge is concerned. We're going to go back and see how things went in round number two, which was held earlier this year in Atlanta.
Wonderful job.
Put it up there like this.
David Atkins, who came on strong last year, took the top honors at Daytona in round one. Then on to Atlanta, round number two. Here are the finalists. With spring in the air, parity blossomed as Exide's Peter Jelen took to the racetrack. He's sitting 21st in points and is hopeful for his first Mayflower NASCAR Truck Drivers Challenge victory, which has grown increasingly difficult. We have yet to see last year's champion Rodney Pickler make it past the qualifying round. As the other competitors and some spectators look on, Jelen made this a very, very good run. He was able to complete the distance without a single penalty.
Well, that felt great. Felt real good. No problem, I don't think.
After a sixth-place finish in Daytona, Pennzoil's Tommy Rigsby pushed his rig hard, careful to stay clear of the penalties. This was Tommy's best run to date. He hopes it'll lead to a victory and a shot at the Mayflower $20,000 bonus.
I think that was a pretty good run. It felt pretty good. I just hope it didn't have any penalties.
But it would be Peter Jelen taking the top spot for the day, moving him to 11th in points. Tommy Rigsby would have to settle for second, but he has the points lead heading into round number three at Sears Point. We still wait to hear from last year's trio of Pickler, McCrimmon, and Culbertson as they hope to push their way back atop the point standings. So our congratulations to Peter, who drives the rig that hauls this car, and John Kernan has more on the 7 car.
Bob, Jeff Bodine, who's found himself a lap down after that spin earlier, he has pitted one more time during this caution period. It was a lucky break for him. He took on four tires. They thought they had a right rear tire going down. It was just a little bit soft. Now let's go to Dr. Jerry Punch, who's with Richard Childress.
Well, the good news is the car is back on the racetrack, and Richard Childress is talking to his driver. And RC, sorry to meet like this, but how bad is the car hurt?
Well, you know, it knocked everything off the front. It looks like a chassis is pretty decent. You know, we had to straighten a couple of things, but I just told him go out and try to make the best of it we can right now. That's all we can do.
Any idea, did he say anything about what could have happened up there?
No, nobody ever said anything. We just seen him spin it.
A lot of debris here in the children's pits, and that caution flag was a break for the Earnhardt crew and able to make some repairs and get the car back out without losing a lot of additional laps here under green.
All right, so the Earnhardt car is back out on the racetrack, and Bill Weber has an update on the 75 car of Todd Bodine.
Bob, Todd is still sitting in the factory store sport. They've cut away the front end completely. They've also got heavy rear end damage. They've taped up the spoilers. They won't have any, or the rear spoiler rather, they won't have any trouble getting fuel in the car, but he's got heavy rear end damage. He's up on jack spot. He's just sitting in the car waiting for his crew to make any repairs they can. One update on Terry Labonte, who's run so well today. He is very unhappy with the set of tires he has on that car. He says his steering radius is off about 3 inches on this set compared to the last set he had on. They're not going to bring him in until they get a caution or an opportunity later on. They don't want to give up track position, but they're going to try and string the car. They're pretty sure, though, they just got a mismatched set of tires.
And Terry Labonte at the moment runs in fifth position. With all the work that occurred on the Earnhardt car, he only lost 20 laps for repairs. It's Jeff Gordon at the front now here in Bristol.
In this dirty old part of the city,
where the sun refused to shine. People tell me there ain't no use in trying.
Cold filtered Miller Genuine Draft. The cold one.
We gotta get out of this place.
You know the beer, you know the taste. With Miller Genuine Draft, the world's a very cool place.
For me and you.
Okay, no one really wants to talk about tires, but you know what?
Firestone's having this big sale, and I'm talking about it. Don't touch that remote. I'm looking at tires. The big, the bad, the walk on water. I'm looking at sale prices, too.
But you don't want to talk about it.
So don't. Just take your hoper to catch the red light so people can check me out car and go. You know why? It's big. It's Firestone. It's the big tire sale at Firestone. And like it or not, people are going to be talking.
Save big on high-mileage FR440 radials now at Firestone retailers and Sunday's ads.
If you settle for a remanufactured engine without a brand name, be sure you've got a pair of name brand shoes. AC Delco Engines, the national brand name with the nationwide warranty. Call for a location near you. Of course, if you come in on foot, we'll understand.
When it comes to roping a steer, folks in Grand Junction, Colorado will tell you that Ron Markin can ride with the best of them. When it comes to overhauling an engine or rebuilding a carburetor, well, he can do it all. You see, when Ron's not riding a horse for fun, he's turning a wrench for a living. So he buys a lot of parts, mostly from AutoZone. Sure, there are other parts stores in town, but Ron knows that when you want the right part for the right price, there's just no place better than AutoZone.
We have run less than two laps under green. After our second caution period of the day, Jeff Gordon has the advantage over Mark Martin, John Andretti, Rusty Wallace, and Terry Labonte. Between Gordon and Wallace, Martin, first and second is the 12 car, Derek Cope. He, however, is a lap down in 16.
And once again, on the start, Jeff Gordon jumped out to a good lead. However, Mark Martin was on the outside of Derek Cope and had to deal with that on the first lap, and Coach, of course, on the inside got the position, but it's not for position on the race, but it's position out on the track, but not Coach is running in 16th position one lap down.
Would you guys agree with me that if there has been a surprise as far as first year teams is concerned, it's John Andretti?
He's doing very, very well, particularly here today at Bristol. This is a very tough racetrack, very demanding racetrack. And he is doing a great job in that Kmart car.
He is 10th in points going into this event. One thing we will keep our eye on, of course, here this afternoon, because Earnhardt was involved in a crash, lost so many laps, and Sterling Marlin at the moment is ninth. We'll keep our eye on the point situation. Jerry Punch has...
Oh! David Green crashes down in turn one. Heavy damage to the rear of the interstate battery car. Caution is out.
So after going over 100 laps without caution, we've had three pretty close together here. David Green substituting for Bobby Labonte into the fence in turn one with heavy rear end damage. There you see it on the left rear of the car.
Yeah, that is heavy damage. Too bad, Dave. He really practiced that car. He qualified it well in fifth place, practiced well with it yesterday afternoon, and was looking forward to a good run here today. Even though Bobby had lost a lap, got caught up behind traffic there early in the race, and had lost a lap, he's still in good shape for a good finish.
Makes it around to the pit area. Here's the tail end of it, already into the wall when we picked it up. Here's Jerry in the pits.
Well, the Interstate Battery Chevrolet comes in and has been considerably shortened. As you said, Dan, they were very pleased with what had happened yesterday. In practice, they said that David Green's laps has gotten very consistent. He was running with Mark Martin and Jeff Gordon and some of the others very consistently, but apparently he had trouble, and they are looking as they have the car up on the jack, surveying beneath it. Jimmy May car looked and said apparently they're going to have to go back behind the wall and do some repairs. The entire back lip has been pushed down, and some of the sheet metal has been pushed against the left rear tire. And also the question is the fuel cell. It looks like it's partially been disconnected from its mount, so the car has some significant structural damage in the rear, and they bring him back behind the wall for repairs. Bob?
Once again, we'll take a look at what happened up in turn number one that sent David Green substituting for the injured Bobby Labonte. Up into the wall, there it is, contact with the left rear of the car. He's behind the wall. We're under caution for the third time, but we will resume in just a moment.
In racing, there's no margin for error. The crew follows the same procedures every time the car pulls into the pits. It's the same way at Jiffy Lube. We follow the same strict procedures more than 50,000 times a day. It's your assurance that when you bring your car to Jiffy Lube, the job will be done right. And Jiffy Lube offers Pennzoil. Jiffy Lube, the world's most experienced oil changers. That's why if it doesn't say Jiffy Lube, it just isn't Jiffy Lube.
For the best name brand auto parts you can buy. For quality parts that meet the toughest inspection standards in the business. For lifetime parts warranties, good for as long as you own your vehicle. And for guaranteed low prices, check daily to beat the competition. Don't fool around at just any parts store. Get serious. Get Western Auto.
Today, millions of Americans are running faster with the same size engines and farther on the same amount of fuel. Millions have discovered the patented advantages of the Splitfire spark plug, a difference that delivers on every stroke of every piston. 5 extra horsepower by merely installing these plugs, a 4.8% gain in mileage. If you're not running the Splitfire, you're probably behind someone who is. Splitfire, more power and more mileage for your money back.
At Bristol, and we had hoped to run this shop talk last week after Darlington. We were ran over so much, we postponed it until right after our race this afternoon. Had a letter from a Bill Elliott fan earlier this week saying, when's it going to be on? It's going to be on right after our race here this afternoon, ma'am, so stay tuned. By the way, your driver, Bill Elliott, is 21st a lap down. Here's the green.
Once again, Gordon gets that good jump because he's on the inside, or gets ahead of the car that's on the inside, which is Derek Cope.
That Cope's car is pretty well going strong right now as he closes up on the back bumper of the 24 car.
Remember, it was in the early going, and then as we got some laps on the car, it went away, but it's doing fine now again.
One of our people said that Monaghan David Green, and he said he was bumped. He was bumped by Dave Marcus is what caused the crash.
Looked like a white car that bumped him as he went into turn. Dave's car is pretty white here today.
Mark in second place. He was a pole sitter, eligible for $30,400 in Unocal bonus money. Should he win this race? Running second at the moment, we're on top of the Valvoline Fork. Here is 8th, 9th, and 10th position. That's Darrell Waldrop, Sterling Marlin, and Ted Musgrave.
You look out the window of Ted Musgrave's family channel forward.
There's another Napa Field summary for you. You'll want to see where your favorite driver is at the moment. And you will notice that there are 15 cars on the lead lap.
Back in 23rd, one lap down, he was involved in that spin with the 32.75 and evidently didn't have a great deal of damage.
For many, you'll notice that a while ago, Dale Earnhardt was at the bottom of the standings, but now, because of some other crashes and because he is out there picking up laps, he has moved to 34th, and every point is very, very important.
That's 6 points that he's picked up. He did not lead the race, did he? He never did get to the front, did he?
Never did get that 5 bonus points.
Andretti goes to the inside of Derek Cope. Cope, remember, is a lap car, but Andretti and Wallace are battling for the third position.
Rusty Wallace, he goes down in turn one.
He's been battling John Andretti quite a bit here today. Andretti's doing a great job, as I mentioned earlier, hanging on to third.
Tim Brewer, the crew chief on the 37 car, longtime crew chief for Junior Johnson, but he had so much success here. He knows how to set up a car for the speedway.
There you can see that the difference between first and second, 0.8 of a second, and 2.6 separate 1 through 5. With more on John Andretti, here's Dr. Punch.
Well, as Benny mentioned, Tim Brewer is the crew chief, and Tim and John came here to test for 2 days after Atlanta, the Wednesday and Thursday after Atlanta. The test really wasn't that beneficial. They really didn't know what they had learned because both Andretti and Brewer had the flu, and they couldn't run that many laps consecutively. And Tim said, we won't know until the race starts if what we learned will help us. But Andretti was the other driver. I told you Kyle Petty went to a different gear this morning. Andretti also has the 543 gear in, so he is turning a lot of RPMs, and apparently it's helping him off the corner. Bob?
He is staying ahead of Rusty Wallace in third. Wallace sneaks up at him at the exit of turn number 2.
Good battle here for third and fourth, but there's also a battle shaping up for the lead.
Oh, and into turn number 1, it is Mark Martin passing Jeff Gordon and going back to the front.
Wow. It just seems like a lap ago that Martin was 5 or 6 car lengths behind.
Mark Martin has 4 top 10s in the first 5 events of 1995. Here's how he went to the lead.
This is coming off turn 4 to the front straightaway. As they come down, Mark gets a great run, gets position on Jeff Gordon, and wise that Jeff Gordon decides not to come down.
Yeah, and he had been gaining about 3 car lengths each lap, and so Gordon had to see him coming and knew that he had a lot of momentum.
Back to this battle for third spot between Andretti and Rusty Wallace.
And don't forget about Terry Labonte, because he's right there. Oh. Trust me, there he is.
There he is.
He's gaining on this 2 cars, I do believe.
Yes, he definitely is, Benny. He was a minute ago, he was about a half a straightaway behind, maybe a little more than a minute ago. That 8 or 10 laps ago, he was about a half a straightaway, but he's gained up. He's pulled up on him.
Once again, we have a 3-car tussle between, or among, I should say, Waltrip.
Yeah, make it a 4-car battle.
Yeah. Now,
Waltrip is called Ricky Rudd. He is running in the 7th position.
Ted Musgrave is watching.
Right on the bottom of the racetrack. Groove still hasn't moved up any at all as we see going in the corner. Left wheel touching that yellow line, coming off the corner. Once again, the wheel touching that yellow line, staying as close to the bottom as they possibly can. They will let it drift up in the middle, just a tick.
About that much.
Yeah, just small.
Yeah,
small.
Maybe not quite that much. The car, by the way, at the end of this line is Dave Marcus. He is a lap down in 20th position. The others are battling for position. John Kernan has a comment on the number 10 car. John Kernan.
Well, Bob, as we see, Bristol can tear up a lot of race cars, and Ricky Rudd's crew decided to bring a sacrificial lamb, if you will, the oldest car in their shop they brought to Bristol. Well, yesterday afternoon, when Jeff Bodine lost an oil line, Ricky got into the oil, scraped the wall. They didn't do a whole lot of damage other than sheet metal damage. Bill Engel told me this morning that actually, after he scraped the wall, they brought it in and straightened the sheet metal out. The car was running better than it did before.
Sometimes that happens.
Yeah.
You don't know why, but sometimes it just happens that some little something that you were lacking maybe gets knocked into the right position and makes the car go faster.
Happened to me at Dover, Delaware one time. I just had an average car. I was involved in a crash, and I bent the fender, the hood and the right front fender all up, and from then on, the car just flew.
Did you win the race?
Yeah.
Good for you.
I mean, I don't know what it was. Maybe it was an aerodynamic advantage. I had all that dent sheet metal push the nose down or what, but...
Jeff Burton, we understand, is reporting to his pit crew that he may have a tire going down. He's a lap down in 25th position. Just ahead of him is Michael Waltrip, who is 5 laps down in 32nd.
And Jeff Burton in practice yesterday was one of the fastest cars here. But I talked to the crew this morning. They said the car was extremely loose. It turned very good in the corner, but it was loose. And now the car, they say, is pushing badly, so that is indicative of a flat tire.
or at least below tire.
Below tire.
It doesn't take many pounds of pressure that you lose to pick up in tight situation. That means when you go into the corner that it just simply don't turn the way you want it to. Sometimes you have to back off the gas coming off the turn.
Just behind those cars, the leader of the race, Mark Martin, with about a 5 or 6 car length advantage on second place. Make that an 8 or 9 car length advantage on second place, Jeff Gordon. 185 laps out of 500 completed here at Bristol. And we'll look at the in cars as we go to break. There's Rusty Wallace in fourth. Ken Schrader is in 17th. Dick Trickle runs in 19th position. Ted Musgrave is on the lead lap in 10th. And there is Morgan Shepherd, who is in 28th. We'll be right back.
Saving lives and helping the sick. There's a lot more to it than that. There's compassion and caring, a way of life at Manatee Memorial Hospital. Our dedicated physicians and staff believe that people should be cared for, not just treated. It's that philosophy that helps us provide the type of health care you expect from the community's health care leader. Special support groups, educational services, physician referrals, any health-related topic. Call the professionals at Manatee Memorial.
It's March Magic at your Mercury dealer, and we're making cars disappear with great deals. Like this Mercury Grand Marquis, Florida's best-selling full-size car, with a V8 that can go 100,000 miles between scheduled tune-ups. And Grand Marquis ranked best model in its price class in initial quality by J.D. Power and Associates. And during March Magic, they're disappearing fast. See your Mercury dealer by April 3rd and say,
put me in a Mercury now!
NHL season, it's all crunch time. So when they ice it, hook it, save it, stick it, stop it, play it, and score it, you'll need to know. NHL Tonight on ESPN2. ESPN2. News, features, and highlights. Sports Center for the hockey addict. Tuesday through Saturday at 11:30 p.m. As the clock winds down, the season heats up on ESPN2.
ESPN Speed World coverage of the Food City 500 is being brought to you by Smooth Busch Beer and Easy Drinking Busch Light. Busch, the official beer of NASCAR. By McDonald's, have you had your break today? And by NASCAR 94 Year in Review. To order, call 800-71-NASCAR. The Family Channel blimp is currently in the area, part of its 95 nationwide tour dedicated to promoting the power of family by using the blimp to support charitable organizations involved with the special needs of children and families. So they're doing two services here. They're providing great shots from overhead, and they're making money for charity. Well, here's the leader, Mark Martin.
Coming up on Lake Speed, who is currently two laps down in 29th position. Facing the stand court. Not far from here, there's the one car of Rick Mast. He is in the lead lap in 15th position. He was about to go a lap down earlier on the long green flag run, but he managed to stay out there and stay on the lead lap, and so he's trying to do that right now.
That's Steve Grissom in the black and gold 29, the Meineke car, trying to get by the one first. Steve Grissom, the winner yesterday of the Goodies 250 here at the Busch Grand National Race held yesterday afternoon. Beat this fellow, as a matter of fact. Martin finished second, and Grissom was first.
6.6 seconds separates the first five here at Bristol with almost 200 laps gone. Here's Grissom moving to the inside of Rick Mast, and now Martin trying to move to the inside. We'll lock her down here for a lap, and you can look for your favorite driver and his car, and you can see where he is in relation to the leader of the race and who he's battling with out there on the track.
The Kyle Petty going by the 16th car, taking that spot away, or trying to take that spot away.
That's Anthony Lemon.
Yep. Back to the leader, there's Mark Martin. Now we'll focus in on Kyle Petty and Craig Sachs. Randy LaJoy running in this group. There's Ted Musgrave.
And Kyle did take that spot away from Musgrave. Kyle up in the 10th spot.
Here's a Fran field summary. Now just 14 cars on the lead lap.
Pretty impressive. Couple of rookies, Robin Presley and Ricky Craven, both still in the lead lap.
Andy LaJoy is on top of the standings for Rookie of the Year after five events.
That goes all the way down to 23rd before we see cars that are two laps or more down.
And there you can see Dale Earnhardt is running in 33rd position, 20 laps down because of the crash earlier in the race and the time that he spent behind the wall for repairs. Sterling Marlin and Darrell Waltrip have been running together for a lot of laps. They're now 8th and 9th.
I think Sterling is maybe getting by Darrell.
Yeah, Sterling was following Darrell the last time we saw him, and he has been able to get around him. He's sent Tennessee natives. Well, Darrell maybe not a native, but Tennessee was born in Kentucky, right? Willisburg, but he lives in Tennessee now. Has for a long, long time.
And you know, he said one of the reasons why he likes this racetrack so much and one of the reasons why he's won 12 events here is because it resembles so much a track that he used to run on down in southern Indiana at Salem in his late model days before he moved to the NASCAR Winston Cup Series. Ricky Craven and Bobby Hamilton are running together.
It's not for position. The 41 car is in the lead lap. 43
is one down.
There's Bill Elliott.
Still a couple of laps down the McDonald's Ford. Meanwhile, right behind them is, once again, the 29 car, a lap down, and the leader of the race, the 6 car of Mark Martin and Jeff Gordon. While Mark has caught this traffic and trying to figure out how to get by it, Jeff Gordon, the second place car, the DuPont car, has caught him. And Jeff is saying, okay, I caught this traffic the first 75 laps, it's your turn to fight this traffic.
It gets tough when you come up on cars that are running good. Maybe they might be 2/10 of a second a lap slower, but it's hard to pass them.
Dale Jarrett is having a good run. He's in 6th. And Bill Weber has more on Dale's run. Bill?
Bob, in final practice last night, they threw everything in this car. Shocks, they worked on the track car. Larry McReynolds and Dale Jarrett had long conversations. Then this morning, they changed the header length. They felt that would give them more top end. They were having trouble spinning the tires. They felt that would take care of it. Larry McReynolds just told Dale Jarrett he's running very consistent laps. They're really pleased with his progress. Of course, he's pitted back higher on the backstretch, along with Terry Labonte, who's also having a good run. He started 21st. Gary Dehart just gave me the thumbs up on the Kellogg's Chevrolet. By the way, they wanted long green flag runs for that 5-car today. The longer the green, the longer the run, the better the car, and Terry's coming.
And we have Sterling Marlin, who's also coming in a crash in turn 4.
Right in front of the leaders, it's Dave Marcus, but the leaders are able to go by on the inside. Dave stays up against the wall in the Terabyte car. So that long green flag that Bill Weber was just talking about, Butter went out the window right there.
Our fourth caution of the day comes out on lap 215.
I see some pretty heavy damage to a lot of tire marks on the right rear of Bill Elliott's car. I don't know if that means anything or that was some earlier.
Okay, here we go. The first three coming into the pits. And here is Mark Martin, Jeff Gordon, and John Andretti coming in for pit stops. John Kernan and Andretti's pit.
It'll be a 4-tire change. John still playing the car just a little bit tight in the middle of the turns. Let's go down to Mark Martin's pit and Jerry Punch.
Right side tires already on. Left side going on down. They got all the lug nuts on. Second can of fuel in. He's off the jack and away. As Mark Martin is down, here is Jeff Gordon down here. As Russ Wallace down. And the 37 of John Andretti is now moving down pit road. Let's go to Bill Weber in the back pit.
Dale Jarrett and Terry Labonte are back here, 4 tires and fuel, looking to beat the leaders. Mark Martin goes by, the 24 is by, the 2 goes by. Now the 28 is down here. Long stop for Terry Labonte. They're working on the left side tires. Now Terry pulls away from the 28 pit, but he lost a valuable position. Spinning back here, Sterling Marlin, the last car of the leaders off the backstretch pits.
And Dale Darrell Jarrett picked up two positions back there, pitting on the backstretch. He came out ahead of John Andretti and of Terry Labonte, who was in front of him. Of course, Terry was pitting on the backstretch, too, so he only beat one car that's pitting on the front stretch.
And the 40-car Greg Sachs is nearly stopped here on the main straightaway. We will take a break here. Apparently, the battery has gone sour on the Kendall car. We'll check out that story in just a moment. Meanwhile, we'll take a break and be back with more from Bristol.
Man has always been fascinated with speed. But winning is more than a flash of speed. It's a measure of skill. A test of guts. That's why the true spirit of NASCAR lies not in the machine, but in the man who drives it. We're proud to be part of this great sport. Busch, the official beer of NASCAR.
Michael Jordan is playing NBA basketball again because he missed his teammates. He missed the excitement. He missed playing the game he loves. And he really missed having a McDonald's sandwich named after him. Michael Jordan's McBacon Deluxe. Two all-beef patties, savory bacon, and melted cheese on a double-decker bun. Named after the world's greatest basketball player. So, Michael, what's next? Pro football?
Have you had your quirk today?
You know, at AutoZone, we know our customers work just as hard as we do. So we're open when they need us, at night and on Sundays. And since 2 million folks each week count on AutoZone for what they need, when they need it, we're not about to let them down. That's why we carry so many parts and why we price them so low every day. You see, selling top quality parts at low prices every day is how we make a living. But helping customers, well, that's how we make friends.
The year was 1980 at Baldessarol. Jack Nicklaus outdueled Asawa Oki for the U.S. Open Championship. They started today tied for the lead. 14 golfers within five shots. Look who was chasing them. Final round, live coverage coming up later today, 6 o'clock Eastern Time. We don't have baseball tonight, but we do have something very, very exciting for America's Cup. Team Dennis Conner goes against the Mighty Mary, and again, if Dennis loses tonight, it'll be the first time he's ever been out of the America's Cup this early. Our same day's coverage is at 8:30 Eastern Time tonight from San Diego, America's Cup here on ESPN. Well, we got some replays to show you guys.
Ned, take a look at Dave Marcus. What happens? Looked like he got bumped in the rear there as he came off of turn four up to the outside. And he stays up against the wall. There's the leader, Mark Martin, and Jeff Gordon in second place comes shooting by down on the inside.
Here we see we're in car inside the six car, the Mark Martin Valvoline Ford. And the 71 car goes around into the wall with the left side.
Just ahead of Mark Martin, the leader, and Jeff Gordon. Still under caution, 220 laps completed. We'll be right back.
With new spark plugs, you get improved performance for a while. But only Bosch Platinum has a pure platinum center electrode that's heat-fused for an airtight seal. So Bosch Platinum reaches its self-cleaning temperature faster for full engine power over a longer performance life. Which means you'll replace a lot of other things before you change your Bosch Platinums. Bosch Platinum, the ultimate spark plug.
You can get top brands and top performance at just any auto parts store.
Get serious. Get Western Auto.
Western Auto's a stranger to the
In racing, there's no margin for error. The crew follows the same procedures every time the car pulls into the pits. It's the same way at Jiffy Lube. We follow the same strict procedures more than 50,000 times a day. It's your assurance that when you bring your car to Jiffy Lube, the job will be done right. And Jiffy Lube offers Pennzoil. Jiffy Lube, the world's most experienced oil changers. That's why if it doesn't say Jiffy Lube, it just isn't Jiffy Lube.
ESPN wants you to feel the rush of IndyCar racing.
Enter the ESPN Legend Returns Sweepstakes, sponsored by Firestone, and you can go to the Indy 500 as a member of the Patrick Racing Team. Runners-up get Firestone Firehawk tires or racing jackets. To enter, visit any Firestone tire retailer or send a postcard to the ESPN Legend Returns Sweepstakes, P.O. Box 518, Hermosa Beach, California, 90254. The ESPN Legend Returns Sweepstakes, sponsored by Firestone.
Welcome back to Bristol. Now, there's a shot for you. This is under Dick Trickle's car. Wow. Who do you have contact with?
Oh, he got close. I guess it's Brett Bodine who's on the outside of him. Meanwhile, that's Robert Preston. There he is. Wow. He touched again, didn't he?
Yeah.
It's Robert Presley direct in front of him.
Here comes Brett again.
And they touch again. How the woman keeps crashing.
Brett drifts back a little bit. Now he runs alongside of Ken Schrader. That's what we talk about when we think of Bristol and the short tracks.
You see Kyle Petty once again, who led the race earlier on. He's shown a lot of strength today in that Coors Light car. Pontiac.
By the way, Jeff Gordon is the leader of the race. On the restart, Derek Cope got to the inside and held the position, got the lap back, and Jeff Gordon came also along and took the lead from Mark Martin. But now, as you can see, Cope is going a lap down once again.
And Rusty Wallace's car is pretty good right now. His car has been good on fresh tires. It loses a little bit as the tires get hot. Let's see if that trend continues or if they've adjusted on the car and have right.
I'll bet they make some adjustments on the either the pressure, air pressure, or on the wedge bolts on the car. As you said, he has been good on fresh tires, but as it ran on a while, it seems to move a little bit.
You don't see John Andretti. We've seen him with the two car all day long. He's back. There he is, back there, racing with the 10 car, Ricky Rudd, for fifth spot.
Yeah, Dale Jarrett, as Ned indicated, got off the backstretch pit a little quicker than John Andretti was able to come around. So Dale Jarrett is in fourth, Andretti is in fifth, and Ricky Rudd in sixth.
There's some trouble on the right side. The crew has some trouble on the right side of the 37 car. That's how he lost his spots, and he's back in traffic now. And as we've pretty well established, traffic is a problem at Bristol.
It really is. On Dale Jarrett's behalf, on the restart, he really got jammed up with Jeff Bodine and Jeff Burton and lost a lot of space to the leaders.
There's Terry Labonte at the end of the line. He is in seventh position. Labonte, by the way, won the first short track race of the year. If you divide the tracks according to super speedways and short tracks, then this is the second short track race of the year. If you divide them into medium-sized track and put Richmond in the medium-sized track category, then this is the first short track race of the year. In any case, Terry won everything.
Three-quarter mile track.
Yes. Less than a mile.
Yep.
And Mark Martin has caught Jeff Gordon and pulls alongside.
Yeah, he'll get him going into turn three. Jeff will back off and let him go. Wasn't about to go in there to the outside.
Hey, here's a battle between Ricky Craven and Kyle Petty for 11th.
Kyle gets the position, and here comes Ken Schrader in the Bud car, but he's a lap down.
Yes.
Schrader in 18th position. 14 cars on the lead lap.
Average speed of the race at this point is 91.955 miles an hour. Now the 25 and the 15 are racing for position. Of course, is Ken Schrader and the 15 car of Dick Trickle. Both a lap down, but they're battling for the 18th spot.
And they have the Kodiak car sandwiched between them that is in the lead lap.
Mark Martin up front has led 94 of the first 237 laps. There's Sterling Marlin running behind Brett Bodine. Sterling is in 14th. And we have a switch of position here as Labonte passes Rudd and goes to 6th.
We see 6th, 7th, 8th, and 9th. Darrell is in the 8th spot. Musgrave is in 9th. Glad to see Darrell doing well in that Western Auto Chevrolet, because I went by there the other day, and Pete Peterson, Pete Wright, made me help him put the engine in the car. So, yeah, it's good to see him still do it.
Did you get a free lunch out of the deal?
No.
Oh.
Terrible.
I'm glad the engine hadn't dropped out on the practice.
So am I, Dan.
No, Benny knows what he's doing. They didn't have you get up under the car anyway. He just did the top.
No, he just lifted it into position.
I tried to get between the fender and the roll bar, but I had a little trouble with that.
Well, how come?
My midsection got in the way. Musgrave closes it on the back bumper of Waltrip's number 17 car.
Jack Roush cars, two of them in the top 10. Both of them are in the top 10. Michael Waltrip, by the way, has pulled off the racetrack again. He was back in 29th.
As he watches, I'll tell you that David Green is pulling the Interstate Batters car back on the racetrack after spending a long time, about 90 laps in for damage.
Yeah, he's being shown in last position right now.
Not running very fast, but he's out there.
Well, he's going to get an open spot on the track where there's not a lot of traffic. Get up there on the groove and see how it feels.
There is Earnhardt, and he's now up to 30th position. Hey, he's passing. Look at that.
Yeah, he's going pretty good. Since he came back out, he has stayed on the same lap. He's still just 20 laps down where he was when he came back out on the track.
Now, somehow, I think your aerodynamic argument goes out the window. Right there.
I tell you what, that car is not very aerodynamic. It looks like a boat running around the racetrack. Watch that.
But again, he's up to 30th position, so he has picked up six spots. Back down on the racetrack.
That's 18 points.
Yep.
And boy, you never know how much that might mean at the end of the year.
And he's going by Darrell, and that lets Musgrave get on the inside. That's for position. Position 8, Musgrave has it.
If points were awarded now, Earnhardt would retain the points lead by 13 until just a few minutes ago. Sterling Marlin was in the points lead if points were awarded now. Out there, and we are approaching the halfway point, aren't we?
Yep. Next time by. Right here.
Right there.
There it is. Yep. And cross flags being shown by Darrell Moore, and Mark Martin's leading at the halfway point. 250 down, 250 to go.
Isn't there a prize now for leading at the halfway point net each and every race?
$10,000.
Gatorade.
$10,000? He's won 10 grand?
Yeah.
Yeah, someone.
Man, oh, man. Who's paying that?
Gatorade.
John Kernan has a story on Rusty Wallace running third.
These guys, for Rusty Wallace, leave no stone unturned. This is the right front tire that came off the car after the pit stop. Look at it. No, that's not what happened to the tire on the track. That's what happened after it got back here. They cut it away so they could get a look at the sidewall to check out the damage. A lot of damage to the right front sidewall here, in particular in the shoulder area. They want to see if it's flexing too much and causing a breakage inside here. But as you can look all the way around this tire, and it's also on the other side, tire looks really good. They tell me they don't have any problems with these tires as far as breaking the inside around the shoulder area, so they feel like they're in pretty good shape.
What happens when they underinflate the tires? They break the shoulder, like John Kernan was talking about. So that's an indication. That gives the crews an indication whether or not they could have to up the air pressure or they can let it down some more. That's what they're doing, cutting the tire apart so they can see. And we see Musgrave going by Labonte, and also Kyle Petty has worked his way back up there.
Yeah, Ricky Rudd going by, Darrell Waltrip will go by. A lot of cars there in the lead lap, and the 33 car of Robert Preston goes by as well. So once Terry Labonte got up in that outside groove, boy, the train went right on by.
By the way, speaking of Goodyear, this will be their 1,000th documented win in NASCAR Winston Cup competition here this afternoon. Look at Presley coming up on Waltrip and getting on the brakes. Now,
Dick Trickle almost made this crash. Dick Trickle has spun.
And the 22 car, Brandon LaJoy, has crashed.
And the number one car of Mast hits Trickle in the backstretch.
There's Trickle's disabled mount off of turn two. And five cautions have now waved over Bristol. Dick Trickle is the victim.
See, the left front tire is flat on the 15 car. We can see where he did the donut and landed in that spot. Tell you what, when the wheel is bent like that, like it is on the 15 car,
normally some pretty heavy damage to that car.
Yeah, they'll have to replace some steering parts and who knows what else.
Here's a replay. Originally contact between Presley and Schrader.
Yep. And then back behind, there's Triple spinning around. And then we see the 22 car, Randy LaJoy, up high. And I guess that was another chain reaction type deal. Those cars behind started jamming on brakes.
Here we see Dick Trickle and the four car of Sterling Marlin.
And Sterling Marlin taps Dick Trickle, headed into the turn, just enough to get him out of control.
Trickle goes up, spins. Now, who's going to hit him in the left front and do all this damage? The 29 car of Grissom goes along, hits him in the left front, does all that damage. And meanwhile, I guess the 22 car, once again, was trying to slow down to avoid the accident. And someone,
there's some contact between Trickle and Mast.
Took the rear bumper off Mast's car.
And they've closed. Now the pit road is open.
Here's Jerry Punch.
Well, they were going to momentarily close pit road to allow the blowers to come out on the track and blow some of the rubber off. The drivers had complained and said, please, during a caution flag, please blow off the track, particularly at the exit of turn two and the exit of turn four. Now the cars on the lead pits are going to come down. If you're watching Mark Martin, triple pit stop here on your screen. Mark Martin, our leader, getting right side and left side tires. Let's go to John Kernan.
Rusty Wallace's crew putting on the left side tires. They've taken a round of wedge out of the car to loosen it up. Flush up tightly to Rusty Wallace. He's down and away a really fast pit stop. And he's going to win the race out of the pit.
Here's Bill Weber in the back pit.
Once again, Dale Jarrett and Terry Labonte looking at a four-tire change back here, watching for the leaders. Rusty Wallace goes by as they work on the left side of the Havilland Ford. Gets away. It might have beat the 24 and the 6. Now they're still working on the left rear of Terry Labonte's car. Sterling Marlin down pit road. The Kodak Chevy beats the Kellogg Chevy. They return to the track. One quick story on Sterling Marlin. The reason he was back there fired in traffic was because during the last caution flag stops, they failed to clean the windshield. Sterling was very unhappy. He had to come back in, clean the windshield, and that's what put him back in traffic after he'd been running so well.
And no crewman wants to listen to an unhappy driver. Trust
me. Irritated race driver.
Trust me.
Well, Dick Trickle's car is on the hook. He is still in it, and now we go inside, actually on top of it, to see what happened when Dick got in trouble in turn one.
He got caught just a little bit, and boy, you can see it. And he's going to get hit again. Well, he did. Rick Mast hit him just slightly.
Well, the 15 car goes behind the wall for repairs. We've seen that scenario several times this afternoon, and the track crew comes out to clean up Bristol International Raceway.
When it comes to roping a steer, folks in Grand Junction, Colorado will tell you that Ron Markin can ride with the best of them. And when it comes to overhauling an engine or rebuilding a carburetor, well, he can do it all. You see, when Ron's not riding a horse for fun, he's turning a wrench for a living. So he buys a lot of parts, mostly from AutoZone. Sure, there are other parts stores in town, but Ron knows that when you want the right part for the right price, there's just no place better than AutoZone.
When it comes to building a comfortable home, you certainly have your options. Your home feel as good as it looks requires an essential. Ask for Tyvek House Wrap from DuPont. It helps keep weather out, comfort in. And that's basic to better building.
What, is this your idea of excitement? Let me tell you about exciting, okay? Driving around a racetrack at over 200 miles an hour, that's exciting. These are just flakes.
Well, what do you think?
These are really good. They're crispy, too.
Really?
Yeah, they're mighty good even with nothing on them. What are they?
Hey, Charlie.
Yeah.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes?
Oh, how could I be so dumb?
You got 500 miles to think about it.
Kellogg's is proud to sponsor NASCAR champion Terry Labonte.
Here
He's known as Awesome Bill from Dawsonville, and the man fans have crowned the most popular NASCAR driver of the year a record 9 times. He's Bill Elliott, and this year he returns home to Dawsonville and starts out on a new high as the pilot of the McDonald's Ford and the owner of his own team. This could be his year, and today he's our guest on NASCAR Shop Talk.
That will be immediately following our live coverage of the Food City 500. Bill Weber is with Dick Trickle.
And Dick, you're okay, not very happy. What happened?
Well, you know, we first set of tires, we just were off, but we got real good the second set. The last set, we got loose going in, and we're just waiting for the next yellow to come out, but everybody's a little rambunctious back there. We got a tap in the back coming in water. You know, we're hoping to bring the car around through the day and, you know, get a good finish out of it. But, you know, Bud Moore and Donnie Wingo and this team, you know, they'll get me back out there. We'll try to finish with some points, but disappointing day for us. Just got a little extra help in the back. Can hold on.
Dick Trickle's going to look at his car. Let's go to Dr. Jerry Punch, an update on the 6 car.
If you're wondering why Mark Martin lost the lead in the pit, take a look at his left front fender. Now, he had some contact with the car during one of the earlier caution flags and pushed the left front fender in. When they came down pit road, Steve Mill, who changes the left front tire, had trouble getting the tire on. He had to tell Mark on the radio to turn the steering wheel to the right side, and they were able to wedge the left front tire in. That wedging of the tire cost him an extra 3.5 or 4 seconds in the pits and also cost him the lead. Bob?
Yeah, it sure did. Rusty Wallace is now in the lead. Let's show you the pit summary. Mark Martin lost one position. Jeff Gordon lost one. Rusty Wallace gained two. Dale Jarrett lost one. And John Andretti gained one position.
The difference is Andretti's pitting in the front and Jarrett is pitting in the back. That's right.
Still under caution, the cleanup continues down in turn number one where Dick Trickle was involved in the incident. So we'll take another break and be back with more from Bristol, Tennessee.
It's March Magic at your Mercury dealer, and we're making cars disappear fast with great deals. Now you can save over $1,500 on a V8-equipped Mercury Cougar, or choose $1,000 cash back on Mercury Villager, and save up to $1,750 on Mercury Tracer Trio. You better hurry. With great deals like these, they'll disappear fast. See your Mercury dealer by April 3rd and say,
an editorial from Mr. Larry Holmes.
I'm going to beat Oliver McCall, beat champion again. Foreman did it, I can too. Faster than George, smarter than George, I'm just better than George.
A second opinion.
Mr. Holmes forgets. George didn't fight me.
McCall versus Holmes for the heavyweight title. Plus 3 more championship fights. Saturday, April 8th, live on pay-per-view.
Got that Jim Carrey.
That pet detective guy?
No.
That dumb dumber guy?
No.
The guy in the mask?
Yeah, you know, the goalie.
I didn't know he's a goalie.
Yeah, he's pretty good too.
Welcome back to Bristol and some NASCAR Winston Cup stock car racing on ABC at 4 o'clock. The IndyCar Phoenix 200 will be held, and quite a surprise on the pole. Brian Herta with the Chip Ganassi's team is on the pole with Emerson Fittipaldi, Jacques Villeneuve, Paul Tracy, and Michael Andretti making up the top 5. That race will be on at 4 o'clock Eastern Time. Well, there are the loyal Bristol race fans, the most enthusiastic of any place I think we go.
Man, what a crowd of folks we have here today as we see the Bram field summary.
While we're watching that, an interesting statistic has popped up. When we're talking about the modern era and drivers' performances at Bristol International Raceway, you got it?
Yeah.
You normally think of who? Darrell Waltrip is probably having the best overall finishes.
Right.
Well, who has the best? Darrell Waltrip is second in terms of overall finishes here at Bristol. Who has the best in 24 races?
Bristol.
Benny Parsons.
You're kidding!
How about that? You have a 7.5 finishing average. Darrell has a 7.6 and Earnhardt a 7.7 in the modern era.
You mean I beat Darrell Waltrip and Earnhardt at something?
How about that?
Man.
Congratulations.
Still under caution, it's Rusty Wallace Mark Martin, Jeff Gordon, the top three at Bristol. Stay with us.
Michael Jordan is playing NBA basketball again because he missed his teammates. He missed the excitement. He missed playing the game he loves. And he really missed having a McDonald's sandwich named after him. Michael Jordan's McBacon Deluxe. Two all-beef patties, savory bacon, and melted cheese on a double-decker bun. Named after the world's greatest basketball player. So, Michael, what's next? Pro football?
Have you had your break today?
Put 700 of the world's most powerful horses together, and what do you get? You get out of the way. The Budweiser Ken Schrader Stock Car. See you at the races.
Hey, you know my crew spends hundreds of hours building those 5,000 horsepower motors? I can explode one in 5 seconds. And when that happens, nobody eats. That's why my guys won't run anything but Fram fillers. You know, Fram gets the nasty stuff out of the oil, so I can go to the other end with my candles lit. And you know, that's in about 5 seconds, nearly 300 miles an hour. You can look at these guys and see they eat pretty near every day.
It's the Food City 500, sixth race of the 1995 NASCAR Winston Cup Series, live from Bristol, Tennessee. Overhead is the Family Channel blip. This is one of a few light ships. This thing is internally lighted at night, and man, is it pretty. Anyway, it is 132 feet in length, 44 feet in height, 37 feet wide, and almost 3,000 pounds. It reaches a top speed of 56 miles an hour. Now, let's go to the Bud race recap. At the moment, Rusty Wallace is the leader. He has only, however, led 11 of the first 271 laps. We've had 8 lead changes, 5 cautions, totaling 45 laps, and an average speed way down to 88 miles an hour. Those that have picked up 5 bonus points for leading include Martin, Gordon, Petty, and the current leader, Wallace. Out of race. Not too many. Greg Sachs and Dave Marcus are the only ones officially out of competition, but there are still some cars that sit behind the wall getting work done. Well, Ned, it's been a rather lengthy caution period here.
Yeah, this is the reason the drivers asked NASCAR to ask the track officials to bring the blowers out and blow some of the rubber down off the track, because they say if you get out of the groove, that you're history. And so they have 2 blowers out there, and they've made a complete lap around this track, one on one end and one on the other, so it looks like they're getting pretty good shape.
Kyle Petty is back up to 7th position, Jerry.
They've been battling, the car's been awfully tight, Bob. They took a rubber out of the right front, the car was still too tight, and they put a rubber in the right rear, the car got too loose. They just came in and put a round of bite in the car and put 4 tires on it, and Kyle said, hey, I think we're in good shape right now. We should be able to make our move back toward the front after qualifying 3rd. Bob?
All right, we're just about to go back to green. Rusty Wallace will be at the front of the field. We mentioned that Terry Labonte won the race in Richmond, but Wallace led 248 of the 400 laps, 62% at Richmond, in the first short track race of the year. The crowd once again rises as the green flies.
The scramble begins as they're starting to do the brand, which is the way they restart the races. You get down to the last 10 laps, the more if you get up on that outside, which the lead cars are, it makes it tough.
The wall. Several others scramble and lose control, but gather it in, and once again the caution flies.
That all started and fire momentarily on Kyle's car, but it got out.
Brett Bodine is smoking heavily.
Yeah, Brett has hit something pretty hard. He spins off of turn 2 over there.
The 11 car just spun coming off corner number 2 after going down into 1 with a lot of smoke coming from the car.
I think we'll see on the replay that what happened, Dale Jarrett got on the inside going into turn 3 over there on the inside of John Andretti. John went very high.
What's this all about here?
That's just a raw fuel. When he tries to restart the car, he opens the carburetor.
We understand that the oil cooler has been split in the 11 car.
So we see the damage to the left front of the car. As the car started stopping, evidently Brett ran in the back of someone, knocked the oil cooler off of it.
Brings the junior Johnson car in. Here's a replay now. There you can see, Ned, that's right.
Yeah, Dale had already passed John Andretti. John went high, and I'm sure Kyle probably tried to get to the inside or either jammed his brakes on, and somebody ran into him, and up into the wall he went.
And from the Family Channel blimp, here you can see Andretti moving high. Yep, Jeff Burton.
Eight car, Jeff Burton catches Kyle in the left rear, and Kyle hits it with the rear and slams it hard with the right front. And
see lots of cars back there really doing scrambling around. Now, how about the 11 car, Brett Bodine?
There he is trailing smoke. This is in turn one. As he takes it into two, he spins.
I guess he's trying to get to the pits.
Yeah, but I believe that he had some contact with someone or the wall back up there trying to get slowed down when Kyle Petty hit the wall.
Well, he goes behind the wall for repairs. Lowe's Ford will need some work.
See what we can see from the Family Channel car. There's the 8. Jeff Burton goes up, taps Kyle.
Well, Kyle Petty had such a good beginning to this race. He led early on, but has a contact with the wall. Dropped him back to 20th position. Dale Earnhardt is up there third in line behind the pace car. He officially on the serial scoring is in 30th position, 20 laps down.
And he earlier made some contact with another car and hit the wall almost the same spot that Kyle Petty just hit the wall. That's the damage we see the 3 car.
And they're going to have to start work on that to see if they can get it back into competition. We understand that Brett Bodine hit the back of the 33 car. That's the reason that the oil cooler was damaged on that car. And there is Robert Presley in the pits here on the main straightaway.
And they're working on the rear spoiler, trying to attach it, reattach it, I guess, where the 11 car hit it. Brett Bodine hit it. And
now, from Ken Schrader's car, let's see what we can see.
Hard into the wall.
Good indication of just how severe the contact was. There's Schrader riding it out. Here it is again.
No question there. Jeff Burton got into the left rear quarter panel with Kyle Petty and slammed into the wall. You see some other cars making some contact. And boy, what a great job.
Yeah, that was Presley, Ned, after he had been hit by Bodine.
Yeah.
And John Kernan is with Brett.
Brett's crew is working underneath. You just see all the oil that is just shot back under all over the engine and on the hood. And Brett couldn't slow down in time. Could you get to the back of the 33?
Yeah, evidently they crashed up there in front of us, and Robert checked up, and I just couldn't get stopped in time, and you know, I hit him hard enough and broke the fitting off the oil cooler. It was a shame that Lowe's car was running awfully good today. Finally, we got ourselves where we could be competitive, and it's just terrible. Restarts, you know, the fast cars are stuck in the outside lane. You know, I was running 10th, 12th, and I ended up starting 24th on a restart in the outside. It's just really hard to stay on the lead lap under those conditions. You put new tires on the lap down cars, and they can run awfully good down there in that inside lane.
Well, that's Brett Bodine. This crew is working. What we're being told they're planning to do is bypassing the oil cooler, so they'll save some time. They won't actually replace the whole thing. They'll just bypass it and get it back out on the track as soon as they can.
And the work also continues on the Kyle Petty car. The 75 of Todd Bodine is back into the race. He is 40 laps down in 32nd. And some fans of the young age are here enjoying this race at Bristol.
King Top Fuel Dragster. Who says you need wings to fly?
Ooh, the clean machine.
machine from Coleman PowerMate does such a great job cleaning cars and decks and grills, you may find yourself testing its power on all sorts of things. The Clean Machine from Coleman PowerMate.
My son, the graduate.
So, Nikki, any plans now that high school's over?
You know, it's gonna work for me.
Not if you're smart.
You know what I think you should do? Stay close to home.
You've got plenty of time to work.
Take the first thing that comes along, Nick.
Give Anthony a call.
So what are you gonna do?
Well, I'm gonna study nuclear propulsion
or satellite navigation.
In the Navy.
Oh, great.
Way to go, Nikki. For more information on the high-tech skills that can help launch a career, call 1-800-USA-NAVY.
Now, an oil made just for your hard-working engine. 4x4 from Quaker State. Off-roading, extreme temperatures, towing and hauling. They all make your light truck or 4x4 work extra hard and could shorten its life. Why settle for a conventional car oil? Get 4x4 from Quaker State.
Now, an independent test proved 4x4 superior to leading conventional car oils in protecting against deposits that can shorten engine life.
And two laps under green, and it is Rusty Wallace at the front of the field. Bobby Hamilton trying to get the lap back. Mark Martin runs in second, and Jeff Gordon is in third position, and Hamilton drives her to the bottom of the track, forcing Rusty Hyde, gets the lap back, but Rusty hangs onto the lead as he got down in front of Mark Martin.
Man, that old Bobby Hamilton going someplace in that STP Pontiac.
Yeah, that's tough. Puts 14 cars, or 13 cars, back into the lead lap. We were down to 12.
Let's see if he can stay up there for 30, 40 laps. So we run 30, 40 laps on the green.
John can update us on the 43 cars back on the lead lap.
Bob, you remember earlier I told you about Ricky Rutschker bringing the sacrificial lambs to track, an old car, because of how this place will eat up cars? Well, not the 43 team. Robbie Loomis said that is a brand new car built especially for Bristol. What they've done is they've strengthened the chassis with some X bars in the rear, some Y bars in the front. The problem here at Bristol, just the force, the sheer force, caused the firewalls to actually twist from the and flex, and they would be out of shape when they get the car back to the shop. So as the race went on, the car would lose its setup. He said, with his firmer chassis, that they should be fine throughout the entire 500 laps. Well, Kyle Petty is behind the wall, and Dr. Jared Punch is standing by with him.
Taking a good run by Pontiacs. Kyle, you had a great one going, and I think I jinxed you, partner. I just said during the break that we're going to watch Kyle because you got the car dialed in, and then boom, you're in trouble. What happened?
Well, we started, we were a little tight. Then we took that out, and we got tighter. It seemed like we took a rubber out. So finally, we said slamming in the right rear, and the car got pretty good. But on that restart, somebody got into the 37, the John Andretti going into turn three, and I checked up, and somebody got in the back of me. But hey, it's racing here at Bristol. There's nothing you can do. It's nobody's fault. It's just one of those deals. When something happens in front of you, and things happen so quick, like we talked about yesterday during that race, it's going to take out two or three people, and it took out me this time.
You had a suggestion that we go bass fishing at Darlington. Any thoughts about here?
Yeah, this place ain't good enough for bass. They need to put carp in this place.
Kyle Petty able to smile after a tough day in Bristol, guys.
Kyle has his opinion of the racetrack.
Sure does. Waste no words either. Ted Musgrave's car once again. He's in seventh position. Waltrip up ahead is in sixth. And Tim Trader is right behind. But he is one lap down in
16th position.
You get a ride against the ball.
Bear with me.
You know, 295 from new 96, one.
Oh, I ain't about to start doing that.
Uh-oh, Mark, take a look on the inside of Rusty Wallace.
Tell you what, that six car, that Babbling 40 is a rocket ship here this afternoon.
It is fast.
This is the 19th, the last 21 races that the number two car has led to the short track.
And Earnhardt's keeping up pretty well with that red car.
Yeah, he is.
Staying right with the leaders.
And he's up to 27th position now.
Let's see, he doesn't have fender, so that air is able to get to the rear spoiler. Now, folks, I'm just kidding. I have no idea.
Now, don't start that.
Yeah, right.
We'll get into a Hornets test. Sterling Marlin has just gone.
Oh, Rusty, did he hit the wall? Came off the fourth corner, got the car sideways, and I thought maybe he brushed the wall, but evidently not. He's still going.
You're going to give me heart failure.
Well, gave me heart failure, too, and I thought I'd share it with you.
Well, let's take a look. Here he comes off the turn. Gets her sideways. No, he's not close to the wall.
Even close to the wall, BP.
Oh, I just happened to catch him out of the corner of my eye. Sorry.
Less than 200 laps to go.
Bobby Hamilton has just driven away from Rusty Wallace. He's the fastest car on the
racetrack. I think Mark Martin is probably faster than Rusty Wallace right now, but again, as we've talked earlier, he might be 0.2 seconds faster, but passing and catching is two different things here.
Yep. Sterling Marlin is on the move. He's up now to eighth position and looking for seventh inside Ted Musgrave.
There, Ted moves up to the
move. Oh, makes contact. Did those two cars as Ricky Rudd goes by and drops Musgrave another spot back. He's back to ninth now.
Well, let's count them up. How many Fords we got in the top 10, Benny? We got first and second for Ford, then fourth, fifth,
eighth, ninth.
That's it.
Yep.
Not bad for the Fords today. And the manufacturer's points battle. There you go. Four Chevys in the top 10, six Fords, no Pontiacs. Three Chevys in the 11 through 20, five Fords, two Pontiacs. And then 21 through 30 and 31 through 36. 10th and 11th here, that's Ricky Craven and Terry Labonte.
Right on their back bumper is Robert Preston, the green car.
Bill Weber has more on the Terry Labonte run this afternoon. He's in 11th looking for 10th.
And he was running closer to the front, but when they pitted under the last caution, Terry came in, took his four tires and fuel, went back out on the track. They discussed it. He had talked about his car being a little loose. They brought him back in, tightened up the car with two rounds of wedge. That dropped him deep to the field. Really fighting through traffic. He's faster than the cars in front of him, but this is a tough place to get by him.
Well, he just disposed of Ricky Craven and gave him a little nudge there when he did.
It's almost impossible to pass here without giving someone a nudge.
Robert Presley came along also and dropped Craven back to 12th.
So apparently that bump in the rear didn't hurt Presley that much.
Doesn't seem to.
Brett Bodine, you saw there at the bottom of your screen, going back out onto the racetrack, and now it becomes a battle for eighth between Rudd and Musgrave.
But you know, the fans must love all this beating and banging and bumps, because they turn out at Bristol in droves.
Yes, they do. It's, 70,000 seats here now, and they have plans for a seating capacity of 100,000. There goes Musgrave taking the spot away from Rudd. Just a second ago, we saw Sterling Marlin go to sixth position, dropping Darrell Walker back to seventh.
That's what I was going to say.
Oh, great minds work together, they say.
Stole my line. Well, we saw the new sweep down between three and four.
They're building new roads here to accommodate the 100,000 people. They hope to build grandstands all the way around. Look at Earnhardt. He stayed right on the back bumper of Jeff Gordon, who's running third.
If the sheet metal is an aerodynamic advantage here, we're only talking about 0.05 seconds. And Earnhardt, you know, if he had the fastest car here, if he was 0.1 second faster, he could lose the front end and still be faster. If he, in fact, was the fastest car, so.
I think he approved he was the fastest car. He had come from 24th position up to second before he had his wreck. And that was without the advantage of a car. Simply had come up through there.
For those of you just joining us, Earnhardt was involved in an accident very early in the race, doing extensive damage to the car in turn number four, spent about 20 laps in the pit, and now has worked his way back up to 28th position since coming back into the event.
We see that he's once again standing right on the back bump of the 24 car. First three cars.
cars, Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin, and Jeff Horton.
According to my stopwatch, Rusty is not running quite as fast as Mark Martin was when he was leading the race. It's about 2/10 of a second difference, really. But, you know, things have changed on the racetrack. There's a little oil and grease. Uh-oh, run up on the 18 car. Three abreast there for a moment, and they made it.
Man, I tell you what, that was some heads-up driving by all those guys. David Green including, that was the 18 car that was three of deep on the outside. There we go. There's David Green in the 18, and Mark thought he was going to have to pass him on the outside. He goes up to do that, and Jeff looked on the inside.
And Jeff wisely backed off. He said, hey, this is going to be smart to do this, not at this point of the race. So good heads-up driving by all three drivers.
Now we're going to go back and show you exactly what happened to Dale Earnhardt.
There he is going by the Derek Cope car going down in turn three. He goes down and they just touch, and Earnhardt goes around. He spins. Now he stands on the gas trying to make the thing do a 360, and the front comes around and smacks the wall and did some pretty heavy damage to the car.
And he lost 20 laps behind the wall, and he stayed 20 laps behind ever since he came back out.
It is still Rusty Wallace in the lead. Mark Martin is running in second position, and Jeff Gordon third, with 323 of 500 laps completed at Bristol.
If you're on the lookout for quality used auto parts and tons of them, Jim's Auto Salvage in Sebring is the first and last stop you need to make. We've been in the auto salvage business for over 25 years and have over 40 acres of parts inventory. Individuals and dealers alike will find our warehouses stocked full of late model auto and truck parts. Jim's Auto Salvage delivers daily to businesses throughout Central Florida. Save your money. Why buy new when used will do just fine? Come see us soon at Jim's Auto Salvage and Jim's Import Auto Salvage, both serving you in Sebring.
Action is the main attraction, showing the one.
It's the Parts Plus
Super Chevy Show at DeSoto Memorial Dragway, April 8th at 9th.
8 wondering.
200 mile per hour Pro Mods.
Awesome.
Powered buddy cars. It's the biggest all Chevy event in the country.
Plus, the Be of Goodrich Tires Car Show, Customs Rods, a Swampy.
April 8th and 9th, DeSoto Memorial Dragway.
The Parts Plus Super Chevy Show.
Get discount coupons now at all Parts Plus stores.
Friday night at 8:30 Eastern, Adrian Stone clashes with James Hughes for the USBA Welterweight Championship. Top Rank Boxing on ESPN.
Back at Bristol, and a sampling of what you're going to see later here on ESPN, right after our coverage of this race at Shop Talk. Bill Elliott, the special guest, 4:30. Slam Dunk Contest from Seattle with Brad Nessler and Dick Vitale at 5. The Tradition comes on at 6 o'clock Eastern. Raymond Floyd, the defending champion there. Then later we're going to have an edition of SportsCenter, followed by at 8:30, coverage of the America's Cup. And then the Big Shoe at 11 o'clock tonight with all the latest news from the world of sports on SportsCenter.
That's the Big Shoe or the Big, Big Shoe?
Well, it's at least big. Could be the Big, Big. Dick Trickle's back in the race as we watch Wallace leading Martin.
Mark Martin says they had to put up with that kid all first 250. Last time we had to put up with Rusty Wallace, it looks like.
Rusty Wallace's average finish, 2.15 the last 20 races on short tracks.
Yeah.
Just a little more than second position. Well, there's Jeff Gordon in third. Jeff has led a considerable amount of this race.
Jeff's just sitting there riding, I believe.
There's Jeff Bodine. He went by. He's in 14th, a lap down.
There is the fourth place car of Dale Jarrett. And Dale is having a good run in that car today. And really, overall, the season has been good for Dale as they're high up in the points.
And the four car just passed John Andretti to take over that fifth spot. So Sterling Marlin started back, but he's marched into the front. And Andretti, the Kmart Little Caesars car, is now sixth place.
Play of how Sterling moved to the inside of John.
Turn one. Andretti moves up.
Andretti's got a nice little donut there on the side of the car, doesn't he?
Mm-hmm. Well, courtesy of Derek Cope is 15th to lap down. Meanwhile, Ted Musgrave, the 16 car, the family kind of car, 7th spot.
Now he's caught John and Brady.
Donato Light Field summary. Tim Brewer has told John Andretti to baby the right front tire. By the way, this is the only track under a mile that Goodyear runs an interliner, and it's on the right front.
Yeah. Evidently, the car is pushing. It must be pushing a little bit, and they're seeing some wear or something in the right front. And Brewer's telling Andretti, take it easy, because, you know, they figure there'll be another caution flag. They'll be able to change tires. And
I think they're definitely going to have to make one more pit stop before this race is over, whether it's under caution or green or whatever. And so he wants to take care of it, because if you abuse that tire, the more you abuse it, the worse the problem is going to get. It's just keep heating up and pushing more and more. So that's good advice that Tim Brewer is giving.
Because the harder they drive in the corner, the hotter that right front set is. Ned says it, the hotter it gets. And the hotter, the more air pressure that it builds up. And the harder the tire becomes, the more the car pushes. It's just a catch-22 situation.
It's just like the 8 car, Jeff Burton, came into the pits. I thought he was going to come in for a routine pit stop, but instead has gone behind the wall. Jeff Burton behind the wall.
They have the hood up on the car and working on it, Bob, so they'll try to get him back out as we watch this battle here for the 6th position.
There's the best of sport.
Yep.
And there's Peter Jones, looked like staying on the wall, the truck driver, the winning truck driver down in Atlanta, the Mayflower Challenge. With the 5 car, Jerry Labonte, he's the 8th place car. Darrell Walter is 9th, and Robert Presley is 10th, or who's 9th? Darrell still is.
Good run for Presley, though. We haven't talked about him very much, but he has stayed on the lead lap and in the top 10.
I asked Leo Jackson, the owner of the 33 car, the Stoke car, last night how Robert was doing. He said, man, he's really running good, but he's probably got a wreck here 4 or 5 times before he gets to learn patience here. So, but Robert's doing great today.
And dropping back to Ricky Craven, who is in 11th position. He and Randy LaJoy locked up in a great battle for Rookie of the Year honors.
Oh, and then Randy spins, and Musgrave spins. Let's see.
Later.
Oh, and the 41 car runs over the back of the 21. He got up in the air.
Jeff Bodine's trying to get a lap back. He's trying to race Rusty Wallace back. He saw all of that. But the 18 car is going to get in his way, and he's not going to be able to do it.
And here comes the 23. Ooh, and the 7 crashes.
Bodine into the wall on the front stretch. Grazes it.
What they were doing, trying to get a lap back, racing back to the flag, and Spencer was trying to do the same thing, got in front of Jeff Bodine, or got in his way, as they both had a head of steam coming down through there.
I tell you what, if we've got a replay on that 41 car looked like a daredevil back there going up in the air, and we see the left front tire is flat. It's knocked the air out of that left front on the X-side battery car.
Well, let's take a look.
Here we go, the 16-37 get together. And both those cars spin because, see, the 16 gets hit by the 12. Let's see. Labonte's able to go through. Here comes the 33. He gets hit by
Schrader.
The 21 slows down. Watch the 41.
Whoa.
Man, oh, man.
I did not see that. Way up.
All up over the top
Shepherd.
Of Morgan Shepherd.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Here's Rusty Wallace, the leader, John Kernan there.
Four tire change for Rusty Wallace. All four tires are on Rusty. Looks like he may win the race out of the pits again as Mark Martin. Jeff Burton still on the Jackson. Yes, Rusty wins the race out of the pits. Another excellent stop for this crew. Let's go to the back pits now and Bill Weber.
Dale Jarrett and Terry Labonte are back here. Terry Labonte went too far and had to be pushed back over the line. Four tires and fuel for these cars back here. Watching for the leaders go by. Rusty goes by, working on the left rear of the Havilland. It's down and away, 21.3, still working on the Kellogg Chevrolet, having trouble getting the left rear tire on. He's too close to the wall, they're having trouble jacking it up. Now Terry Labonte is down, and once again, he'll have to fight his way through the field. They dropped the air pressure. pressure on the left side. Tires of the Haviland Ford by 1 pound.
And over here on the front stretch is John Andretti. John?
Looks like damage on the right front as they try to pull the sheet metal away. They're changing right side tires now and trying to pull the sheet metal away, telling John to go on. They'll come back around, then they'll change the left side tires. But you guys out on the outside of the track might be able to get a better look. But John has told Tim Brewer's crew chief he doesn't think there's any damage other than sheet metal damage.
But there sure is on the 21 car. I think you're right. I don't think there's any serious damage on the 37. But Morgan Shepherd had a car almost in the cockpit with him.
Yeah, and Morgan had got through the wreck, basically. He was going to be okay until Craven came along.
This ought to be good.
And let's listen.
Because we heard his father saying, go high, go high.
And he was going to be okay. He was going to be okay
shot
up there if he hadn't got hit in the rear.
37 gets a little high. Musgrave thought about going under. And the 12 car touches the 16. Then both those cars spin. And it starts from there.
Musgrave really getting more damage than Andretti in that particular portion of the crash. But we got a lot of angles of this, and we'll take a look at it from a robotic camera on turn two. Now watch Craven come along here and right up on the side of Shepherd from the blimp.
Same thing, those two cars get together, Andretti and Musgrave, and then Musgrave gets hit by Derek Cope, and then they start jamming up behind. There goes Ricky Craven up on the left rear, Morgan Shepherd.
And he also went up on the 25.
He landed on the 25, as a matter of fact.
Yeah. Now, here's what happened to Jeff Bodine.
Trying to get a lap back. And Spencer had ducked down to the inside. The 18 car was run along low on the groove, which he was supposed to, but they just simply ran out of room. There was nowhere else to go. They all trying to get to the same place at the same time, and they wrecked.
As a matter of fact, the 23 car did get a lap back. Spencer did. Here comes Spencer. He and Bodine get together, but Spencer beats Rusty Wallace, and Bodine into the wall with that left front.
And once again, Morgan Shepherd's in-car slow-mo.
Can you imagine what Schrader said? What was that?
Okay, well, let's take a look from Schrader's car. He'll be behind him, of course.
He hits Robert Preston. Morgan hits Schrader.
Now from Ted Musgrave. Get a very good shot, though, of Craven going up on the Shepherd and Schrader cars.
They're just on the Panhard bar, trying to run it down.
Well, John Andretti is back out there. However, Ted Musgrave is still in for adjustments on the Family Channel car. We'll be right back.
Rusty Wallace stock car. Awesome. One opened up.
I love my new hot rod. Those flames scare the other guys. 5,000 horsepower helps too. And a fat bankroll. You know, we've been running Autolite spark plugs forever, but I could wring more money out of someone else. Money's good. My crew burns it. So I tell the guys we're going to run a different plug. They say no. I say I'm the boss. They say Autolite keeps this monster lit. So I tell them I was just kidding.
What, is this your idea of excitement? Let me tell you about exciting, okay? Driving around a racetrack at over 200 miles an hour, that's exciting. These are just flakes.
Well, what do you think?
These are really good. They're crispy, too.
Really?
Yeah, they're mighty good even with nothing on them. What are they?
Hey, Charlie.
Yeah.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes?
How could I be so dumb?
You got 500 miles to think about it.
Kellogg's is proud to sponsor NASCAR champion Terry Labonte.
You know, at AutoZone, we know our customers work just as hard as we do. So we're open when they need us, at night and on Sundays. And since 2 million folks each week count on AutoZone for what they need, when they need it, we're not about to let them down. That's why we carry so many parts and why we price them so low every day. You see, selling top quality parts at low prices every day is how we make a living. But helping customers, well, that's how we make friends.
Rusty Wallace still leads the Food City 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race from Bristol International Raceway in Tennessee. Mark Martin running second, and Jeff Wharton is third, with Dale Jarrett fourth and Sterling Marlin in fifth spot. And of course, Dale Earnhardt, who's right behind the leader, was unable to get a lap back when we went green. And Jerry is with Ricky Craven.
Ricky, you took a wild ride after what happened? We tried to stop when they piled up here in two. Up to the brake line, and then, I was hoping I wasn't going to have to talk to you until the end of the race, but it wasn't to be. I'm happy for everyone at Harlan and Kodiak Chevrolet, and I wanted to give my wife a good birthday present, her birthday today, and that didn't work out, but say hi to everybody back in the week. If you're having trouble hearing Craven, what he was telling you was he had a broken brake line and he couldn't get the car stopped.
Now Earnhardt does get the lap back, and Rusty loses the lead to Mark Martin.
And Mark Martin takes the lead, and here comes Gordon to take over second spot, and he does it.
Now Earnhardt is only 19 laps down.
And Martin don't care if he makes up a lap. He'll let him make up a lap.
Absolutely. Gave him the opening he needed.
Gave him the opening he needed to take the lead.
So Gordon now is second, and Rusty back to third. Okay, here we go with Robert Presley and Bobby Hamilton. And Hamilton is still on the lead lap in ninth position. Presley, however, is in 14th, a lap down. So Hamilton is the last car now on the lead lap.
And Bobby Hamilton actually led a lap during that caution. He stayed out there. He was the last car on the lead lap, so it worked great for him to stay out there and lead lap and get 5 points point. There's Hart.
Well, Earnhardt's losing the lap again to Mark. Martin, the pole sitter here this afternoon. The winner has come from the pole 17 times in 68 races at this facility.
You see the 28 car, Dale Jarrett, the Texaco car, passed Sterling Marlin a couple of laps ago, or four or five laps ago, to take over that four spot. There's Marlin, the four car, the Kodak Film Chevrolet in fifth, and there's 17, Darrell Walter. Looks like his car is handling just a little bit better in sixth spot, and Rudd in seventh.
Four car battle here.
Martin checked out after he got around Earnhardt.
Bill Elliott, by the way, only a lap down in the 11th. McDonald's Ford. And that's Steve Grissom right behind Bill.
And Steve is 2 laps down.
Yeah, 17.
There are six cars that are 1 lap down, 9 cars in the lead lap, and then 10th through 15th are 1 lap down.
You see their leader, Mark Martin. That's Kenny Schrader, the Budweiser Chevrolet, on the inside, and look at the damage that he has to the rear of that car where the 41 land on top of him, Ned.
Now, boy, that's an aerodynamic disadvantage. Can you imagine the downforce that he has back there now, or maybe the lack of it?
The lack of it.
That's right, yeah.
Because the air is just not hitting the spoiler now.
When Schrader and Earnhardt get side by side, you wonder which one of them is damaged the worst. I think Earnhardt is that bad.
Well, but his car will run faster right now than Schrader's will.
Yeah. Here comes Jarrett and Marlin to the high side of Schrader.
Well, we can see the Schrader's car is really slow from his damage. Jeff Bodine back on the racetrack. Darrell Waltrip makes a little contact with Schrader as he goes by.
White smoke, a little puff of white smoke. Not too far off of the what? Second turn is a it's a junkyard, is what it is.
Salvage yard.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Car salvage yard.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Some politically correct terminology here. Anyway.
All the restaurants around Charlotte love this kind of race because they get all kinds of sheet metal to hang up in their restaurant.
Hey, here's some downforce. This is, of course, looking out the back of Schrader's car.
Man, that's nasty.
The air doesn't know where to go there, does it?
That is really nasty. Bobby Hamilton passed Terry Labonte, took over that eighth spot.
Great run from Bobby Hamilton, and Bill Weber has a report on Terry Labonte.
Well, Terry went back out, complained the car is very loose. He's starting to drift very high in 3 and 4, and for the first time today on the track, he's starting to go backwards. He's radioed his crew. He believes one of his rear jack bolts is backing itself out, so every time they crank wedge into it, it's cranking itself back out as he makes laps here at Bristol.
I will continue to watch that situation, but back up front it is Mark Martin with a sizable lead now on Jeff Gordon. How much is it? Well, let's check out an AutoZone on-track interval. Now from laps 373 to 377, it went from a half second to a 1.1 second interval between Martin and Gordon.
The interval that we see, a second and a half on Jeff Gordon.
In front of 70,000 plus spectators here at Bristol, it is Mark Martin and Ford leading the Smooth City 500. Three of the top five are Fords. They're running first, third, and fourth at the moment, with just a little more than 100 laps to go.
The Chevrolet's running second and fifth, and the Pontiac of Bobby Hamilton as fast as any of those cars, I think, if he could get in the right situation.
Yep, he is in eighth, of course. Mark Martin won the fall race here at Bristol in 1993, looking for his first victory in the spring race at Bristol.
Crew spends hundreds of hours building those 5,000 horsepower motors. I can explode one in 5 seconds. And when that happens, nobody eats. That's why my guys won't run anything but Fram fillers. You know, Fram gets the nasty stuff out of the oil, so I can go to the other end with my candles lit. And you know, that's in about 5 seconds, nearly 300 miles an hour. You can look at these guys and see they eat pretty near every day.
Filtered Miller Genuine Draft, the cold one. You know the beer, you know the taste. With Miller Genuine Draft, the world's a very cool place.
Tennis, the sport of gentlemen, where things are always returned to their proper place. Faults are taken in stride. Everyone serves with pride. And love means never having to say you're sorry. Davis Cup continues tonight at midnight. Advantage ESPN.
ESPN's Speed World coverage of the Food City 500 from Bristol, Tennessee, being brought to you by Allied Signals Fram Filters. You can pay a little now or a lot later. By cold-filtered Miller Genuine Draft, making the world a very cool place. And by Goodyear, number one in tires. Here are the top 15 now as we show you an Autolite Field Summary. Nine cars on the lead lap. And we'll show you the rest of the field in just a moment. John Andretti, by the way, just black flagged. They came in and they tore the front end off the car and sent him back out there.
Yeah, the front bumper.
Yep.
Air dam was loose on it, waving in the breeze, and so he had to come in and get it taken off. So that cost John, he's now about five laps down.
NASCAR's told the Kenny Schrader team that he's slow enough that they would like for him to stay high and leave these guys the front runners, the preferred line. Normally the slower cars go to the inside, but the inside here is such the preferred line.
Here's Jeff Gordon coming up on the back bumper of Morgan Shepherd. Shepherd is between, or was between, Mark Martin and Gordon.
Shepherd is being shown three laps down, 18th position.
Bobby Hamilton up to eight.
Ricky Rudd is seventh place, the tied for it, and right now Bobby Hamilton is 1.8 seconds behind Rudd. We'll keep a track on that and see if Hamilton is gaining. We'll see what 1.8 seconds is. About a straight lap, not yet. Almost a straight lap.
They're about a half a lap behind the leader.
Now, folks, I mean, I realize that you think I'm just pumping the show up and what have you, but trust me, the 24 car is gaining on the 6.
Yes, that 1.8 second interval that we saw a little while ago is no longer.
It's nothing there right now. Jeff has been caught up in some traffic. I mean, Mark has been caught up in some traffic.
John has already been in that traffic, but meanwhile, Jeff Gordon has closed up right on the back bumper.
Two wins already for Jeff Gordon this year.
Going for the lead.
Yeah, he's got the lead.
Something's wrong with Mark.
Gordon goes back into the lead. Mark has led 155 laps so far, and as soon as our computers pick over, we'll tell you how many Jeff Gordon has led as he now adds to his total, being back at the front. He's led 107 laps. It's a 1.2 second separation between Rudd and Hamilton for seventh position as Bobby goes to the inside of Ward Burton. And Jerry, what is the story on Mark Martin?
I just spoke with Steve Bill, guys, and he says that the problem is not with us, it's with the 24 cars, that our laps are consistent. But the 24 car has gotten quicker and quicker each time by, and so he passes, and we haven't slowed down, he is speeding up.
That's pretty impressive, Ned.
It really is. Maybe he's just been sitting there not dominating this race like he's dominated the other races so that there wouldn't be all the heat on the Monte Carlo. I guess that's part of his strategy. So when the time comes to go, then go.
He can go. We can see that Rusty Wallace has just about caught Mark Martin.
Rusty forces third.
Jeff Bodine between the two cars. Jeff goes up and Rusty Wallace goes underneath. And meanwhile, Dale Earnhardt is keeping up with Rusty Wallace. There's Darrell Walker, the 17 car. He's currently sixth. Ricky Rudd is seventh, so that means that Bobby Hamilton is gaining on both sixth and seventh.
Yeah, it's just a little over a half second now between Rudd and Hamilton. Bodine's woundy car there. Now it's just a matter of car lengths between Hamilton and Rudd.
And he's no longer a half a lap behind. I said a little bit ago he's half a lap behind. He's not quite a half a lap now, so he's even gaining on the leader.
and probably not getting the advantage of the traffic that the leader would be getting. The guys are probably not getting out of his way as quickly as they would Jeff Gordon's or Mark Martin.
Although the leaders are still in traffic. Here is that traffic.
Yeah, Jeff's trying to, he goes to the bottom side of Davy Jones, and now Lake Speed going into turn number three. He makes that pass easily. Here comes Martin, who has Michael Walters right on his back. Michael is 10 laps down in 23rd spot. Jeff Gordon looking for his fifth NASCAR Winston Cup victory, but this, if he should win today, would be his first on a short track.
And his third this year.
That's right, in only six races. Wow.
There's no doubt that the 24 car has been the dominant car of the early part of the NASCAR Winston Cup season.
Yep.
No doubt.
If he had luck his way, he could have conceivably won every event this year. He has led every event. There's Dale Jarrett running fourth.
He's staying about the same distance behind Rusty Wallace.
Pulled away from the four car.
And here come Marlin and Waltrip.
I'll tell you what.
The jam up behind them.
That Musgrave, he's in the race for fifth spot right now.
I mean Musgrave.
Schrader watching these guys go down in turn three. That's Kenny Schrader. He had the misfortune of car landing on top of him. Can you say that?
Yeah, really. Now from first to fifth, it is a 7.3 second interval, but first to second only 1.2.
That 7.3 is not quite a half a lap, but not far from a half a lap.
Here goes Hamilton on the inside, just blows right by Ricky Rudd.
Hamilton has a great run going for Richard Petty and Pontiac here today. There's Darrell Waltrip in sixth position, a 12-time winner, and that's the next car that Bobby Hamilton has his eyes on. Back with more live coverage of the Blue City 500 from Bristol, Tennessee, where Jeff Gordon is the leader.
We put these glass walls on the course at Road Atlanta to demonstrate the wet traction and performance of the Goodyear Eagle Aqua Tread. Racing-inspired dual aqua channels sweep water away for outstanding wet traction. Broad shoulders add aggressive grip for precise cornering. Its unique tread compound helps you stick to the road. You get the performance of an eagle, the wet traction of an aqua tread. Eagle Aqua Tread, only from Goodyear.
When it comes to roping a steer, folks in Grand Junction, Colorado will tell you that Ron Markin can ride with the best of them. And when it comes to overhauling an engine or rebuilding a carburetor, well, he can do it all. You see, when Ron's not riding a horse for fun, he's turning a wrench for a living. So he buys a lot of parts, mostly from AutoZone. Sure, there are other parts stores in town, but Ron knows that when you want the right part for the right price, there's just no place better than AutoZone.
When traffic congestion changes, the threats to your car's engine change. That's why Quaker State has engineered intelligent oil. Oil that senses the changing threats in your engine and adapts its own molecular structure for continuous protection. So whenever the driving conditions change, so does Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life.
Now you can change to the intelligent oil and save $3.60 on a case of Quaker State. See store display for details.
Track facts are brought to you by Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life.
In 1995, the weight was reduced on these Winston Cup cars by 100 pounds. We all know how tough losing weight is. How'd you like to lose 100 pounds? Well, they've got to do it 1 ounce at a time. We see where the oil filter goes. See the boss where it sits? They cut that away on the blocks because it's not needed. Because they run a remote oil filter to get it away from debris. You can see where it's been, the block has been cut away. Also, other pieces that are used for machining this block It's not needed once the block is machined. All that is cut away, trying to save the few ounces they possibly can. We can see where all the machining was done on this block. One other area. This is a steel fitting that a water line goes to. Much heavier than, say, an aluminum fitting. So why wouldn't they use aluminum? Watch as we weigh this. This steel fitting weighs 0.1275 kilograms. Watch as we weigh an aluminum fitting. 0.0460. Why not use a lighter fitting? Because if that baby breaks, all the water goes under the wheels of the race car and you stand a chance of ruining a $100,000 race car. Sometimes you just can't take a chance, even for weight.
May I suggest another way to trim weight, Benny? Just take the whole front end off.
Men and I were talking about that during a commercial break, and they don't weigh these cars, so the fact that Earnhardt has lost, what, probably 10 pounds of weight is not really a good thing, isn't it?
No, it won't disqualify him because NASCAR would take that into consideration. Say if he should finish up in the top 10 or something like that with it, well, they probably would weigh it, but they also would take it into consideration, the weight that he's lost.
Well, Dale Earnhardt has battled back to now run 26th position. He is still 20 laps down. He has not gained a lap since he came back out on the race.
No, but he has not lost one either.
Right.
But talking about that weight situation, I'll bet what we see missing from his race car wouldn't weigh, what, 15 pounds at most?
I said 10. It'd probably be 10 or 15 pounds.
Here's Darrell Waltrip in 6th position. Just ahead is Sterling Marlin.
And look what's sneaking up there, that 43 car.
Bobby Hamilton is lurking.
He's 7th place right now. Ricky Rudd is still continuing to follow Hamilton. He's 8th.
Those are the only cars on the lead lap. 9th place, Terry Labonte, a lap down.
29th car, Steve Grissom, yesterday's winner of the Goody's 250 Busch Grand National race.
And that's Chuck Bown that they're going around to the high side of the racetrack. The pole sitter here last year.
Steve Grissom is a couple laps down. He was involved in that crash with Dick Trickle.
By the way, Bobby Hamilton's best career finish came in 1991 as 6th. So he is, what, within one position of equaling that at the moment. The highest running rookie is Robert Presley, who is slapped down in 11th position. And as you can see, Presley is currently 3rd in NASCAR Winston Cup rookie points. Randy LaJoie and Ricky Craven, 1st and 2nd. Now here comes Mark Martin up to put another lap on him.
And Ricky Rudd was able to get back by Bobby Hamilton. Hamilton ran across the 29 car. Rudd saw the advantage, jumped on the inside, took the spot away.
Well, there's been some traffic in there that's just been atrocious for a number of cars.
Here's how Rudd passed Hamilton.
Well, Bobby went high, following Steve Grissom, and that opened the door for Rudd down on the inside, and he took advantage of it.
We see Rudd. Also, we see Darrell Waltrip trying to chase down the 4 car.
Now Waltrip, that's caught in this
a good spot.
They've been in some heavy traffic. Rusty Wallace and Dale Jarrett went through it. Jarrett's still back there in a lot of it. As a result, Sterling Marlin almost caught Jarrett at one time. He was over a straightaway ahead of him that got caught up in that traffic, and boy, it don't take long.
Now Jimmy Spencer's between the 2 cars, but Darrell gets alongside Spencer. You know, if you're wondering about Jeff Gordon, the leader of the race, yeah, he's still leading. How close is Mark Martin? Not very close.
But Dr. Jerry Punch has a report on Jeff Gordon.
Guys, a moment ago, the facial expressions of the DuPont crew went from smiles to frowns because Jeff Gordon radioed Ray Abraham and said, hey, the car has started to miss. It's sputtering and missing. And they said, no, it's coming back. It's coming back. And then he called back and said, no, it's missing again. Now it's coming back. And apparently it has come back and has not missed now for the last 3 or 4 laps, but they are holding their breath here in the DuPont pit.
Well, they've got 56 more laps to hold it, and I'm not sure they can live that long.
But his lap speeds are still pretty good. He's still turning laps as faster than anyone out there. And he has a pretty good lead. In fact, he has a 4 second lead, just a fraction over 4 seconds over Mark Martin.
Boy, Jeff has a tremendous advantage when it comes to bonus points awarded this year. He has 40 bonus points accumulated. Dale Earnhardt second on that list with 25. Of course, you get bonus points for leading a race and leading the most. Now here's Waltrip. Well, actually, Marlon Waltrip, Rudd, and Hamilton. All running right together on the racetrack beneath Lake Speed.
5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th.
As far as up front, it is a 4-second interval between Jeff Wharton and Mark Martin.
What's the matter? You take Ned's word for it?
Well, you're telling me this is a
position. Okay.
Ned is, I must admit, though, as many years as he's been doing the stock watches, almost an expert. Okay.
He's probably more official than the official.
Ken Schrader brings the button machine in.
Less than 50 laps to go.
They click off pretty fast when they're under green. And this really has been a relatively fast race. We have had 7 caution periods for 65 laps. The average speed of the race is 90.204. And Jeff Gordon's last lap was 109.1. Back after this.
When traffic congestion changes, the threats to your car's engine change. That's why Quaker State has engineered intelligent oil. Oil that senses the changing threats in your engine and adapts its own molecular structure for continuous protection. So whenever the driving conditions change, so does Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life.
Now you can change to the intelligent oil and save $3.60 on a case of Quaker State. See store display for details.
Why do I think the Whopper just beat the Big Mac 2-1 in the taste test? Well, think about it. The Whopper is one big, juicy, flame-broiled burger complemented by the perfect-sized bun. The Big Mac, on the other hand, is stacked bread with 2 smaller fried burgers in between. Bun, burger, bun, burger, bun. Say that 3 times fast. Better yet, don't. You might sprain your tongue. And then how would you eat your Whopper?
The burger that beat the Big Mac. The Whopper Value Meal for $2.99 at Burger King.
This is the inspiration behind Goodyear's newest AquaTread, the all-new Wrangler AquaTread for light trucks and sport utilities. 2 aqua channels sweep water away. You get the sheer rugged toughness of a Goodyear Wrangler and the outstanding wet traction of a Goodyear AquaTread. Welcome to the AquaTread family. The new 50,000-mile Wrangler AquaTread, only from Goodyear.
If you're driving with worn shocks or struts, it could affect your ability to make sudden stops. At times like this, even a small distance can make a big difference. With worn-out shocks, your tires could lose contact with the road. But with new Monroe shocks, your tires hold the road, providing extra control, which could improve your braking. Make the road a safer place with Monroe. Get Monroe Gasmatic Plus and Gas Magnum Plus shocks and struts at a retailer near you.
To soothe athlete's foot, Desinex does it. But to cure athlete's foot, Desinex does it. Only Desinex has UDA to both soothe the discomfort and kill the fungus. To soothe and cure, Desinex does it all.
Shake it, no dandruff. You've got Selsun Power. Brush it, no flakes. You've got Selsun Power with Selsun Blue. Doctors recommend it number 1 over all leading brands. Dandruff problem? No way. You've got Selsun Power.
Well, since it started its national tour in September of 92, the Family Channel blimp has delighted thousands of spectators with aerials over fairs and festivals and sporting events in more than 90 cities, 35 states. There it is, the Family Channel blimp providing the overhead shots for us today here at Bristol. Well, Dale Jarrett has fallen to 6th position, and look at this.
His last stage off about 0.3 of a second, Bob, from what they were running earlier. What's the problem, Bill?
Ned.
Chad Dale just can't get off the corner anymore. They've been working on this all weekend, and now he's just radioed back to his crew that he's having trouble in the turns, and he just can't get off the corner. They're happy with their run to this point, but it's going to be a disappointing finish for him. Davey Adelson won from the backstretch here the first race in 1990, and they were hoping to pull off another one today.
What are you doing, Bill? Spinning the tires off the corner? They're loose off the corner?
That's the problem they had last night in final practice, Benny. They were working on that. The change they made on the headers this morning, they were hoping would take care of that, and they believe it has up until this point. But it just now, Dale just doesn't have it coming off the turn anymore. Let's go to Dr. Jerry Punch of the 24th.
Remember I told you a minute ago that Jeff Gordon said the car was sputtering a little bit, missing, and it would catch back and run okay? Well, he hasn't commented about it missing anymore, but better safe than sorry. Ray Evernham and the crew sent a crew member running back to the truck, and they brought back to the pit area a new carburetor, just in case they might need it. Hopefully they won't, but it's here if they need it, Bob.
They've only got 33 laps to go, and this one will be history as Gordon continues to lead. It is interesting to note that when Dale Earnhardt won this race here last year, he took the points lead from Ernie Irvin. Right now, if points were awarded at this moment, Dale Earnhardt would not be in the points lead, but he would be five behind Sterling Marlin, who is running in fourth position, and Dale Earnhardt is 25th. So we could have a new points leader at the end of this event. And it's amazing how many laps they can run here in a short one. They can run almost or better than 40 laps in about 10 minutes, Benny, something like that?
About 40 laps in 10 minutes. Right now we have 30 laps to go, and this race is going to be over in less than 10 minutes if there's not a caution flag.
And Jeff Gordon, as you can see, is about to lap the 43 car of Bobby Hamilton, running eighth, but his separation back to second place, his advantage over Mark Martin is almost 4 seconds.
Yeah, he's only lost about a tenth of a second since the last time we fought, which was about 20 or 25 laps ago. So he's not really losing at this time.
So he can't afford to sit behind. Oh, whoops. And what happened to Jeff as he came off the corner?
I think he lost traction, got a little bit sideways, backed off of it, and said, hey, I don't need to be trying to be a hero here and straighten that thing out. He just backed off and let her straighten out and then come back at him again.
And he was right on the back bumper of the 43, and all of a sudden car just slipped. Now the 43 is trying to get by the, you know, that's a problem. Right now the 43 car is trying to get by the 17. The 17 trying to get by the 28. You know, they're not as concerned about Jeff Gordon as are themselves.
Right, they're going to try to hold their position.
Who wins this race? That's right. Would be it Jeff Gordon or Mark Martin.
I think Dale's holding them up a little bit there right now. This car, just as Bill Weber pointed out, just got some traction when he's off the corner. He's got plenty of horsepower there. Darrell comes down on the inside. And the train will go by.
Yep.
Door is open.
It is just about 4 o'clock Eastern time. For those of you joining us, welcome to the closing laps of the Food City 500. Only 24 to go. The leader is on the right side of your screen. That is Jeff Gordon, car number 24. In 1/2 hour at 4:30, our Shop Talk presentation tonight, or this afternoon, will feature Bill Elliott, who is 14th, 3 laps down.
Hamilton has moved into that 7th spot. Darrell off at the 6th. There we see the Autolite field summary.
Now there's just 8 cars in the lead lap.
Now Dale Jerry is actually lapped down, so 7 cars now in the lead lap.
Yeah, 7 cars.
It looks like Jeff Gordon is kind of content to follow these 2 cars.
Ricky Rudd is reporting that his car is very loose. Marlin goes inside of Rick Mast. Here comes Rudd right behind. One laps to go for Jeff Gordon. Excuse me, Ned.
Rick Mast is 2 laps down. Now Rick Mast has lost to Ross Presley.
Darrell Waltrip has caught Ricky Rudd. Rudd driving a loose car. Here goes Darrell on the inside. Takes that spot away. Is the 43 car going to be able to get it? He can't.
So Darrell moves to fifth now.
And you see Jeff Gordon. They're not outrunning Jeff Gordon right now. Jeff has just backed off and said, these guys are racing for position. I'm not going to get up there because right now Martin is not gaining on me. I might be even gaining on Mark Martin, the second place car. So let these guys race. I'll ride to the end, which is only 17 laps from now.
17 laps to go, and that is exactly the message that the crew is conveying to Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, he's almost 6 seconds ahead now, so he is gaining on Mark Martin. So he does not need to take any chances whatsoever.
Darrell Waltrip beginning to draw away from these two. If Waltrip can stay in fifth position, it'll be his 25th top five here at Bristol. It's a 5.6-second interval between Jeff Gordon and second place Mark Martin.
Bobby Hamilton looking on the inside. He has that spot. Passing Ricky Rudd for sixth place.
Say that would equal his best ever finish if he finishes there, but that's on his mind because he lost right there with Darrell Walker before they got into all that traffic.
Well, there is fifth right ahead of him, Sterling Marlin. And both coming up on a lot of traffic. It just
well, actually, Darrell has passed Sterling. He's taken over fourth.
That's right. He's in fourth position now. Marlin back to fifth.
And Hamilton is closed up. Evidently, Sterling Marlin finding a loose condition, push something.
But now Ricky Rudd comes back on Hamilton when they get jammed up with slower traffic.
Him sixth and seventh.
And Jimmy Spencer on the outside, the 23 car, letting those guys go. Hamilton trying to get alongside. Takes a look on the inside of the four car. He's going to take this spot away for fifth.
How about that? Bobby Hamilton goes to fifth position.
He was allowed down at one time.
Yep.
Great run.
Looking for his highest finish ever in NASCAR Winston Cup competition. And there goes Rudd also to the inside of Sterling Marlin and putting Marlin back to seventh.
That means that Dale Earnhardt, if things continue, will still be leading the points when this thing is over.
That is correct. By nine, if points were awarded right now, Earnhardt would have a nine.
And Mark Martin is slow. Mark Martin is coming into the pits. He's got a flat tire.
Wow, Mark giving up second position here with 10 laps to go because of a flat tire.
Oh, man, the right rear tire is flat on the six car. Man.
Just a terrible break for Mark Martin, who started from the pole and ran up in the top two or three most of the race. Quick tire change on the right side, and Mark goes back out on the racetrack, but he is a lap down. There is the leader, Jeff Gordon, eight laps to go. This is a guy that we have watched grow up on ESPN from Thursday night and Saturday night Thunder, but if he wins this race today, it'll be his first victory on ESPN.
Really? That's right.
Huh. He's won a couple of races that we've been involved in on ABC, but he's never won an ESPN race.
Well, actually, Mark Martin is two laps down now.
He lost another one.
He lost a lap as he was coming into the pits and then changing the tire, lost another lap.
Jeff Gordon, born in California, grew up in...
What's he doing way up there? Man, there's loose stuff up there, Jeff Boyd.
That'll get you in trouble in a hurry.
Just five laps to go.
I tell you what, Mark Martin had a tire go down. You know, could Jeff Gordon be having the same? Oh!
And nice save by Robert Presley. Oh, man.
Dale Jarrett unlatching himself from Jeff Gordon. Now, whether Jeff just backed off that much, he probably has. There, Mark Martin getting one of his laps back.
With Rusty, or rather Mark Martin in for a pit stop, that puts Rusty Wallace in second, and this man, Darrell Waltrip, in third, followed by Hamilton and Rudd. There is Mark Martin just ahead of the 24 car. That break has dropped him down to ninth.
Sterling Marlin is all over the track. I think he has a flat tire.
He must have a flat tire. The right rear is flat. The right rear is flat on the four car.
But there's only two more laps to go.
And he'll ride it out.
One would think that he would. Jeff, whether Ward
all
Burton.
Over the track.
Yeah, Ward Burton had to slam on the brakes right behind him.
But Jeff Gordon, you know that his tire is a white flag for Gordon.
One more lap for Jeff. But anything can happen.
The 12 car's up in front of him. I think he has a flat tire going into turn three, but he's up high on the racetrack.
Here comes Jeff off the fourth corner. Is he going to win it? Yes, he will. Jeff Gordon takes the checkered flag and wins his first career short track. And look at Darrell Waltrip lead Bobby Hamilton down, and Waltrip, by a car length, holds on for third. Here's John Kernan
with Ray Evernham. And Ray, were you worried at all? I mean, you saw Mark come in with a flat tire, Sterling apparently a flat tire.
Yeah, we were really worried, you know, but like I always say, got to thank God first and everybody else second. You know, Jeff drove a great race. These guys did a great job in the pits. Goodyear brought us an excellent tire. And, you know, I really thought that we were beat today, but we kept working on that thing. And that kid's an awesome driver. I really can't tell you. He's really got this team pumped up.
Well, you remember what Ray said last year. Being with Jeff Gordon is like winning the lottery.
It's his third win of the season, fifth career win, first at Bristol in his fifth start. And, yes, Chevy wins again. We'll be right back.
In these days of overpriced sporting events and overpaid athletes, have you ever wondered where today's heroes are? The ones who thrive on the love of competition and not the love of money? A facility where family values still mean something, and they take pride in what they offer. The excitement, the price, the fun. Come see America's premier sport in action. Come see the Knights in black and white satin.
Leeds Building Products offers top quality in every category. Lumber, plywood, drywall, roofing, insulation, siding, plumbing, heating, electrical. When it comes to building materials, we've got it all. Free delivery, free project estimate. Good old-fashioned service and everyday low prices. Leeds Building Products.
Dakota, right wing with the Islanders. Please, don't confuse me with the actor Abe Vigoda on the TV series Barney Miller.
Hey, pass me the puck, Fish.
Don't call me Fish, rookie!
The young man who grew up in Indiana because that was one of the few states but allow a 13-year-old to drive a sprint car. Jeff Gordon has won for the third time this year in NASCAR Winston Cup competition. He is still in his car in victory lane, and in just a moment he's going to be stepping out of the car. Here he is to the thunderous applause of the crowd.
Hey! Yeah!
Here's Jerry Punch.
And they're hand slapping and congratulating down here in victory lane as Gordon gets up. And yeah, he wants those folks to be able to see. Congratulations, Jeff, on an outstanding effort.
Hey, this just took this team to a new level. You know, short tracks where we've always had our trouble. We've always had our problems here at Bristol. And I'm just happy all four fenders are left on this thing. That was our goal. And man, we've had good cars here in the past, but you know, this is wonderful. I gotta thank DuPont Automotive Fishes. They've been great. Gotta thank Valvoline. The Goodyear tires were excellent. And gotta say hey to Coca-Cola too. Thanks a lot.
Gotta ask you, with 100 laps to go, Mark was leading the race, you're running second, and suddenly you just zipped by and took off. Were you holding back and sort of saving the car?
No, not at all. You know, my car just took a while to come in, and we never ran long enough green flag laps. My car was tight. It was tight. These guys kept loosening up all day long. And all of a sudden, that last stop, they got it just right. It wasn't very good on new tires, and them guys got out away from me. But all of a sudden, man, that thing just, I don't know what, it's like it just hooked onto a rail and just took off. I mean, it was driving itself. My foot fell asleep. And it was hurting so bad before I got by Mark, and then after I got by Mark, I didn't even know I had it asleep, and it's still hurting.
A little race car medicine. Now, we heard you comment that the car may have had a miss or sputtered a little bit, and the guys in the pit started scrambling, looking for carburetors. And what was that?
I have no idea. You know, I didn't know how far we could go on gas. I thought maybe we ran out of gas. I switched the ignition boxes. Never felt it again. You know, it's a scary moment, but yeah, when it's your day, it's your day. Nobody's going to take it away from you.
We might mention there was a good luck charm riding in the car, and Brooke Seeley, you Brooks Ely Gordon, I should say. What was the good luck charm today?
Well, last night we were real nervous about this race, and so I looked in the Bible and I found in Psalms a verse that said, "The Lord is my strength and my shield," and I wrote it in there. And Jeff, right before he went out, we were like, "Where's the verse? We'd forgot to put it in there." And one of the team guys went back to the trailer and taped it in there. He wasn't going to go out till it was in there, so it was in there the whole time.
So saved by a verse from Psalms, and it is on the dashboard inside the DuPont Chevrolet, and Jeff Gordon, his third victory in six starts,
Bob. And he also, once again, leads the most laps, so he picks up 10 bonus points here at Bristol this afternoon. Shop Talk coming up with Bill Elliott at 4:30.
Come on along and head for the mountains of bush beer. Head for the mountains, it's cold and it's smooth, and it's waiting for you. Come on, head for the mountains of bush beer.
We put these glass walls on the course at Road Atlanta to demonstrate the Goodyear Eagle Aqua Tread. Dual aqua channels sweep water away for outstanding wet traction. Eagle Aqua Tread, only from Goodyear.
You know, at AutoZone, we know our customers work just as hard as we do. So we're open when they need us, at night and on Sundays. And since 2 million folks each week count on AutoZone for what they need, when they need it, we're not about to let them down. That's why we carry so many parts and why we price them so low every day. You see, selling top quality parts at low prices every day is how we make a living. But helping customers, well, that's how we make friends.
This NHL season, it's all crunch time. So when they ice it, hook it, save it, stick it, stop it, play it, and score it. You'll need to know. NHL Tonight on ESPN2. ESPN2. News, features, and highlights. Sports Center for the Hockey Addict. Tuesday through Saturday at 11:30 p.m. As the clock winds down, the season heats up on ESPN2.
Welcome back to Bristol. Standing with Rusty Wallace, a second place finish today. A good run for you. We were talking about downforce. It's been a popular topic, a factor again today.
Yeah, I guess so. It looks like they got us again. But, hey, I'm real happy with the second place finish. The car ran good. And I led a lot of the race today and made a pit stop. And I guess I got my air pressures off a little bit on one restart. I just couldn't get the car to go on restarts. But after I could run for a while, it was okay. But right there at the end of the race, I'm glad we're about out of time because I was getting awful loose out there, but it was a good race. I just want to thank all my sponsors, Miller, Fleetwood RVs, and Mobile, and Bosch, everybody. Everybody did a great job today, and all the crew did a good job. Motor ran perfect, but that's racing, and I'm happy to get a second after the luck I've been through.
I can make it a little happier. 16th to 9th in points, Rusty.
Well, that's nothing wrong with that. It's just I sure appreciate that, and I just got to keep laying the numbers on the board now to try to get the points up there. Last week at Darlington really hurting the points because we were really charging to the front. But, hey, that's racing, and we'll just keep on going.
Rusty, second here today. Coming back, John Curtin will talk with Sterling Marlin. Jeff Gordon, the winner here at Bristol today.
Now, an oil made just for your hardworking engine. 4x4 from Quaker State. Off-roading. Extreme temperatures. Towing and hauling, they all make your light truck or 4x4 work extra hard and could shorten its life. Why settle for a conventional car oil? Get 4x4 from Quaker State.
Now, an independent test proved 4x4 superior to leading conventional car oils in protecting against deposits that can shorten engine life.
I love my new hot rod. Those flames scare the other guys. 5,000 horsepower helps too. And a fat bankroll. You know, we've been running Autolite spark plugs forever, but I could wring more money out of someone else. Money's good. My crew burns it. So I tell the guys we're going to run a different plug. They say no. I say I'm the boss. They say Autolite keeps this monster lit. So I tell them I was just kidding.
Do you know how much sprinkles you've got? More from this can than you thought. Fill the bowl from a Pringles can. Got as much as this bag. Amazing, man. Can you believe how much Pringles you got? So pop the Pringles, don't stop. Get the great taste you want, not the greasy mess this bag got. Pringles, once you pop, so much more than you ever thought. You can't stop.
Stay up there,
Welcome back to Bristol International Raceway, Bristol, Tennessee. And as we take a look at the right rear tire that came off of Sterling Marlin's Kodak Films Monte Carlo, you can see we're, down to the cords. That is really down to the cords, Sterling. All the air came out, yet you stayed out there. How difficult was it to finish this race on that flat tire?
It's pretty rough. I tell you, it was really, the back end's wanting to get around on the car, and the car got real loose about the last 20 laps, and we just wore it out and wore it all the way through the cords and blew it out. So we was trying to hang on finish. I believe we'd run third if had nothing happened, but the Kodak team's done a good job, and we finished, survived this place, all fenders on the car.
Now, if you would have finished third, I believe you would have taken over the points lead. You're within striking distance right now. Is this team ready to be consistent the rest of this year and challenge for the title?
Well, the team's been real consistent all year, and every race we had a top five car, and had a little something like this, knocks back to seventh or ninth where we finished. But every week we go out, we feel like we got a top five car, and we win races, and hopefully just keep bearing down, and we'll try to knock Earnhardt out of the championship. But he's tough; he'll be hard to beat.
All right, that's Sterling Marlin. When we come back to the Bristol International Raceway, Dr. Jerry Punch will visit with Darrell Waltrip and Bobby Hamilton.
It's a major breakthrough in auto protectant technology. Formula 2001 Super Protectant. It provides a more brilliant, longer-lasting shine than Armorall on vinyl and leather. And look, in the Arizona desert, Formula 2001 brought back the shine to UV-faded vinyl. Rubber, even leather. Get the new standard in automotive protectant technology. Formula 2001, with 50% more active shining ingredients than Armorall. Get Formula 2001 products today.
Come on along, head for the mountains of Bush Beer. Head for the mountains, it's cold and it's smooth, and it's waiting for you. Come on, head for the mountains of Bush Beer.
This is the inspiration behind Goodyear's new 50,000-mile Wrangler AquaTread. Two aqua channels sweep water away for outstanding wet traction. Welcome to the AquaTread family. New Wrangler AquaTread, only from Goodyear.
I know it sounds crazy, but yeah, I took the High Endurance Challenge from Old Spice. Because I didn't really think it could work better than my old deodorant. But it does. It evaporates less quickly, it also lasts longer, protects better. Try it. If you don't think it's the best, call 1-800-PROVE-IT and they'll buy you a stick of yours. So if you still think every deodorant works the same, take the High Endurance Challenge from Old Spice. Because now you got proof. Guaranteed.
ESPN Speed World being brought to you from Bristol by the more than 1,000 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. By Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life. And by Allied Signals, Autolite spark plugs, guaranteed for 2 years no matter how far you go. As promised, here's Dr. Jerry Punch.
Thank you very much, Bob. I caught up with the third and fourth place finishers. First, we're going to talk with DW, who finished third. And DW, 12 wins at this old tough racetrack, but today a third place finish, almost as good as a victory.
Yeah, well, I was want to say hi to everybody at home and thank Western Auto and thank the good Lord for a safe day. Get that behind us, because I had a great day. I had a lot of fun, was racing hard, but I got to tell my crew, the next time there's 50 laps to go, they got to tell me there's 20 laps to go, and maybe I can catch the guy in front of me. We just fooled around there a little bit long, almost got lapped, and then I checked out and had a good finish. I'm real proud.
Folks, saw this guy at 7 o'clock in the morning this past Tuesday, pedaling away in the exercise room, getting ready for Bristol, and it paid off today. In great shape here, he finishes third. How about finishing fourth? This guy, what a great run from a lap down. Bobby Hamilton, your career best. Congratulations.
It was, Jerry, and the guy's really done a heck of a job on the car. Man, that thing hooked up all day. It was just, the finish was good for me, but I was really proud for these guys. They build real good-looking race cars. And they just deserved it. STP deserved it. I got to race my old hometown buddy, Darrell, there at the end. I said, hometown's at Nashville. I thought we was in Nashville again. But we just had a good time out there. We just needed real long greens once we got our drag position back. And if we had them, I think we'd have been a second or third place car, maybe even a first place car.
Well, we have two guys that have reason to smile, finishing third and fourth as Bobby Hamilton gets his best career finish. We'll be back and have a chat with the highest finishing rookie, Robert Presley, after this. Stay with us.
In these days of overpriced sporting events and overpaid athletes, have you ever wondered where today's heroes are? The ones who thrive on the love of competition and not the love of money? a facility where family values still mean something, and they take pride in what they offer. The excitement, the price, the fun. Come see America's premier sport in action. Come see the Knights in black and white satin.
Today in Montana, the temperature will be absolutely perfect. It'll be perfect in Maine and also in Minnesota. Because now, every oven in every Pizza Hut restaurant across America will be precisely calibrated to the perfect temperature for an absolutely perfect pizza every time. And as always at Pizza Hut, it'll be...
Come back soon, Mr. Riskin.
Sunny and pleasant, even in Alaska. Hey, it's the stuff we're made of.
Friday night at 8:30 Eastern, Adrian Stone clashes with James Hughes for the USBA Welterweight Championship. Top Rank Boxing on ESPN.
How many miles must you walk to reach the tradition? Will you travel as far as Nicholas? Climb as high as Trevino? Cross the void with Palmer? Dig as deep as Floyd and see as far as Player? Keep walking. We all live the quest. That's why we watch. Let ESPN show us the way. The tradition concludes today at 6 Eastern on ESPN.
You know, at AutoZone, we know our customers work just as hard as we do. So we're open when they need us, at night and on Sundays. And since 2 million folks each week count on AutoZone for what they need, when they need it, we're not about to let them down. That's why we carry so many parts and why we price them so low every day. You see, selling top quality parts at low prices every day is how we make a living. But helping customers, well, that's how we make friends.
Jeff Gordon has one here at Bristol. Coming up in just a few minutes at 4:30 Eastern, Shop Talk Slam Dunk Contest at 5, the tradition. Final round coverage live at 6 o'clock Eastern Time. Then Sports Center at 7:30. The big America's Cup race at 8:30 Eastern Time tonight, and then the big show at 11 o'clock. SportsCenter wraps it all up. For the first time this year, the highest finishing rookie is Robert Presley. Here's Bill Weber.
And a top 10 finish, 10th place for Robert Presley. Congratulations. Just an average day for you, huh?
Yeah, it was a good day there. You know, really got taught a lesson about this racetrack, you know, how tough it is. And, you know, we had a good car, Leo, Charlie, all the boys at the shop done good. Motor run great. They said, just sit out there, keep your head, you know, on right. You'll come out of here with a good finish. You know, it looked bad at the start, but looked up one time, we was running fifth or sixth, you know, and I said, you know, man knows what he's talking about. So really happy, you know, just be able to finish the race now.
That's the first one you have finished this year, correct?
Well, first one we ain't took an intermission during the middle, you know, to fix something that we've messed up, but... You know, I'm really happy for all these guys. They've worked hard all year, and, you know, now maybe we can start repaying them back.
Robert Presley, 10th today to the doctor.
And Ricky Rudd, what a great run you had, finishing in fifth in the Tide Ford. Looks like the tires were going away toward the end.
Well, Jerry, we had a little race going. I guess Sterling, myself, Darrell, and then Bobby Hamilton drove a great race today. And we just got all racing each other, and it was who could save their tires the most. And I thought I'd gauge mine just right when it was time to make the move. And I ran, got inside of Darrell, got inside the 43 car, and was coming on and had Sterling lined up. And then just like he flipped the switch, the tires went away. But I was running them pretty hard. So they usually, you know, you expect the car to go away if you run that right rear tire that hard. And that's what happened. So at the very end, we were just trying to keep having to make an unscheduled stop.
Got to be thankful, though, just to be able to walk away from this place with the race car intact.
Well, I'm just real proud of everybody. You know, everybody drove a great race today. They used their heads. It was a give and take. It's a treacherous track. It's a one-groove racetrack. You get out of the groove, you go to the back, and guys worked together all day. You know, everyone came out of here. Most everybody came out here with a race car in one piece.
Ricky able to smile with a good top five finish. We'll be back with more from Bristol International Raceway, including a look at the complete rundown for the Food City 500 after this.
When traffic congestion changes, the threats to your car's engine change. That's why Quaker State has engineered intelligent oil. Oil that senses the changing threats in your engine and adapts its own molecular structure for continuous protection. So whenever the driving conditions change, so does Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life.
Now you can change to the intelligent oil and save $3.60 on a case of Quaker State. See store display for details.
If you don't replace your air and oil filters regularly, you might as well drive your car off a cliff, because dirt can really mess up an engine. Fram Extra Life air filters and Fram Extra Guard oil filters keep out dirt best to protect your engine. Fram, America's number one premium brand. Pay a little now or a lot later. Get a $2 rebate on Fram air filters at participating retailers.
From Darlington to Talladega, through Daytona, Rockingham, and Watkins Glen. In every major NASCAR race, Busch Beer recognizes the pole winner with the Busch Pole Award. Because if there's one thing we know for sure, everyone follows the leader. Busch Beer, proud sponsor and official beer of NASCAR.
Welcome back to Bristol International Raceway. The teams are packing up, getting ready to leave and make the trek back home. Then they'll be at North Wilkesboro next week. I've got the sixth place finisher, Dale Jarrett. And Dale, I believe with the finish, you move up two positions in the points. And you did this from the back stretch today.
Yeah, I'm going to have to learn how to qualify and get us over on the front stretch. But the guys did a really, really good job in the pits all day long. Had a good race car. I think in that first segment before we ever had a caution, we went from 19th up to about 6th. And so you have to have a good race car to be able to do that. Just a little bit tight in the center there at the end, and I kind of abused the right front tire, and that hurt us late in the race.
Well, that's Dale Jarrett's thoughts. He comes home with a sixth-place finish today. Congratulations.
At Bristol International Raceway, the Food City 500 has been won by Jeff Gordon, and here is a full field rundown showing you where the entire field finished. By the way, Jeff Gordon led 204 of the 500 laps here today. The average speed of the race, almost 92 miles an hour. And for Jeff Gordon, as we indicated, it's his third victory in six events this year.
And as you can see, a lot of drivers had had trouble, finished pretty far down the line, but they kept getting their cars fixed and getting back out there and making laps.
Dale Earnhardt started when he had his accident. He was 36th in the field, back on the racetrack, lost one more lap and finished 25th, gained 11 spots for 33 points.
And officially, only three cars were out of the race when the checkered flag dropped. Now, here are the points. The first three stay the same, although Sterling is only 17 behind Dale Earnhardt. Mark Martin still third. Jeff Gordon made the biggest, no, he made the second biggest jump. He jumped four positions from eighth to fourth. Terry Labonte stayed the same. Derek Cope lost two positions. Dale Jarrett gained two. Ted Musgrave lost two. Rusty Wallace was the big gainer today, up seven positions. And Ricky Rudd gained two positions to go into the top 10. And there are the other point standings. John Andretti was 10th going into this event. He drops to 14th. And there you can see 16 through 20 at the conclusion of six races in the Winston Cup season.
And, boy, you can see, you know, all of these are in the 600 range from there up to about, what, 12th or something like that. So the points are very close back down the line.
Next week, we will be at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina for the First Union 400. That is at 1 o'clock Eastern Time next Sunday afternoon. Coming up next here on ESPN, Shop Talk featuring Bill Elliott. A chance to get some inside information from Bill and to buy some of his merchandise. Well, it was in many ways a typical Bristol, but in many ways it was kind of different.
Well, it was typical from the standpoint of a lot of cars getting banged up, Bob. I want to say a quick word about Race Against Drugs that was held here. A special schooling was held. 500 students graduated this week, and a lot of the NASCAR drivers were there for graduation on Thursday night. And boy, that was a fun deal to see all those kids work against Race Against Drugs.
Pretty amazing to me, Penny, that we ran well over 100 laps at the beginning without a caution.
It was amazing. I tell you what, Jeff Gordon proved today that he and that team are for real this year, because they've run good at every venue we've been. Big track, intermediate, and now the short tracks.
A little bit of consistency will make him a championship contender, but you also, of course, have to look at Sterling Marlin, who continues to be consistent, unlike last year. So he is very definitely a championship contender. We're only six races into the season, and we again will be at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, next Sunday afternoon. Congratulations to Jeff Gordon on his third win of 1995 for Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, Bill Weber, John Kernan, and Dr. Jerry Punch. This is Bob Jenkins. Thanks for joining us for now. So long, everyone.